I hope you people brought some coffee with you, and sitting nice and comfy because this one's going to be a long one. The Hero of Oaton by That Guy Vex, episode 16 of The Lunaverse by Rainbow Double Dash, chapter 11, Heart of a Hero, part 2. Trixie felt rising panic in the rattling cage inside her, like a highly irate swarm of parasprites. With a deep, shuddering breath, she took hold of herself. Panic wouldn't serve here. She had to think quickly, clearly, identify the issues, and figure out how to resolve them. Bushel was unconscious, and there was no telling how much worse her condition would become. Trixie felt a gut-stabbing sensation of guilt, looking at the young, yellow filly wrapped up in her star-speckled cape. Trixie was supposed to be the one to protect her, to save Bushel and her town. But Trixie was the one who needed saving. Bushel, Trixie thought as she stroked the filly's forehead, looking at the glowing magical energy in the sweep of a horn that sprouted from between the folds of the young pony's blue mane. You saved my life. Yet you still think I'm the hero here? I won't let you down, whatever I have to do. As to what that was going to entail, Trixie wasn't sure. Looking back at Cheerilee and Tarnus, she could see that Tarnus was still crying into the other mare's shoulder. Cheerilee kept a tight embrace on her friend, and for a moment, her green eyes opened and met Trixie's gaze. Cheerilee gave Trixie a tiny shake of her head, as if to say it was a bad idea to come over or ask any questions. Trixie didn't need any convincing, though she was far from trusting that Tarnus still wasn't a possible threat. Trixie may have cast a mind-shielding spell onto the unstable mare, but all that do is keep the influence of the entity in the forest from being able to worm its way into Tarnus's mind as easily as before. The mind shield was far from a guarantee of Tarnus's continued stability, and she was really anything that could be called stable right now. Then, there was the more immediate issue of the dam. The massive snapping sound of wood could only have meant the dam was failing, and Trixie couldn't guess how much time they had before the entire thing came apart. Her own questionable swimming skills aside, Trixie didn't want to think about what kind of damage the dam breaking would cause. What did we do, Trixie? Asked Raindrops, the Pegasus looking toward the dark silhouette of the dam, where the washing of water from the river was splashing over into the gradually growing waves. Our plan didn't cover up to this point! Thoughts swirled in Trixie's head, and though they were like buzzing bees in her head, she wrangled them into some semblance of order before the panic finally set in. First things first. Raindrops! Take Bushel and head for Oaton. But if the dam breaks, Oaton will be right in the water's path! I know! That's why we need to warn them! And we can't just leave Bushel here! Raindrops stood on all fours, gently using her mouth to move Bushel onto her back. Okay, fine! But what about you and Cheerilee? Trixie looked towards the rubber dam, where the faint orange glow of fire could still be seen despite the heavy rain. I'm going to find Count Shouting, Signing, and Sawdust. Between all of us working together, maybe we can, I don't know, fix the dam? I don't know! If we could just stop this storm! Her mind thought back to the mention of the putrefaction spell in Sawdust's journal. If she could get those notes, she'd know where the rest of the spell was inside Canterlot University. But how could she get there and back to Oaton fast enough? She thought of Twilight Sparkle, and the way the mare used teleportation spell with the casual ease of others use levitation. If Trixie could teleport with the same skill, she could be back here with that purification spell in a matter of minutes. She could just get Luna and bring some alicorn power and expertise to bear on this whole mess. But wishing for that was a waste of time. Trixie hadn't even begun to crack the secrets of teleportation magic, though she made a mental note to redouble her efforts on that front in the future. Tarnished? Trixie looked over at Cheerilee's confused voice and see that Tarnus had slowly pushed their host away from Cheerilee to keep the magenta mare back and staggered to all fours to walk over to Trixie. Trixie tensed, ready to defend herself, but Tarnus's eyes were haunted, looking at Trixie, then at Bushel on Raindrops' back with an anguished twist on her features. I think I could help, she said, a desperate, shaking voice. Help! Raindrops exclaimed, eyes wide, one of them twitching. You just tried to kill all of us! Tarnus flinched back from the Pegasus, though a wash of anger crossed her features as well. The anger was quickly replaced by guilt, and Tarnus began to turn away with a single, defeated nod. Trixie held out her hoof. Raindrops, let's hear her out. We're low on options. You can't seriously be planning to trust her, Raindrops said, looking at Trixie at a glance. Trixie wanted to laugh, but seeing Bushel in that condition drained the thought right out of her. Trust? I'm not a trusting pony. I'm just desperate. Happens to be a good substitute for trust. Cheerilee had trotted to Tronis, putting a hoof on her friend and turning the other mare around. Concern increasing her normally smiling visage into one of tightness as he looked into Tarnus's eyes. What are you thinking of, Tarn? Tarnus looked hesitant, eyes darting between all of them. Trixie saw the other mare look at Bushel's unconscious form, however, and saw Tarnus take a deep breath.
I did just try to hurt all of you. I don't make any excuses. I still feel so angry at you, Cheerilee, for everything! It feels like it's burning my head from the inside out, and I can't make it go away! It's just so hard to think straight! I'm going to fight it, though. I think I can now. I don't know how long, but please, I'm not asking to be forgiven, but let me try to! Let me make up for everything that I've done!
The last was said while staring at Bushel. Trixie could only imagine what Tarnus was thinking, but Trixie had some familiarity with guilt. And Tarnus was looking like a mare who was now all too aware of the mistakes she just made. Trixie was also familiar with the need to make up for those mistakes. And while Trixie was leagues away from being able to actually trust Tarnus, she was actually willing to give the mare a chance to show she was genuine about wanting to help. Trixie decides he'd be watching her closely, though, just in case.
I don't know many animals in the forest along the river, Tarnus said. I've made friends with most of them. Whatever comes into my head, I don't think it infects animals as bad as his ponies. If you could trust me, I'll go get as many as I can to keep the river from flooding. Oh, and I can stop the fire drakes too, before they hurt anybody else.
What? This is something you won't have to do, sister,
said Count Shining, as he and a raccoon of his house guard emerged from the curtain of rain.
Your pets have long been adored.
The Count looked a little better than his sister did. His mane, singed on the short left side of his face, which was marked by a few small burns. He was covered in lighter cuts and bruises, one of his hind legs sporting a purple and swollen bruise that caused him to limp as he walked. Yet, he managed to move with confidence. Tarnus looked at her brother with a guilty and fearful downcast in her eyes. The six guards with him were familiar states of injury, yet there was a tense readiness about them. Especially from the rust-colored unicorn mare cut and dry. She looked ready to personally wrestle the basilisk to the ground. The basilisk, for its part, was looming near Tarnus, giving the scene a casual look of a predator that was supremely assured of superiority. Cut and dry gave the basilisk a wary look. Then her eyes fell on Raindrops, and Trixie cocked her head slightly as seeing the rust-colored mare's eyes flash with concern, quickly covered a moment later. What was that about? Raindrops was visibly injured and battered, but why would Cut and Dry care about that? Trixie put it out of her mind and focused on the Count.
Count Shiny! Trixie began. The dam! We heard it starting to break! We have to! I am already aware and aware of the dam's condition, representative Lulamoon,
Count Shiny said, teeth gritting as he suppressed his stutter.
That is why I am here, to secure my sister and get her out of here before this entire area floods!
Trixie was taken aback by that, eyes widening.
You're just going to abandon Oaton?
I'm not going anywhere with you, brother,
Tarnus said, shakily, backing away, and Cheerilee came up between them.
Shining, you can't seriously be planning to flee just while Oaton is being destroyed!
Count Shining looked as shocked as Trixie felt, his lips splintering as he tried to get something out past his broken composure. Cut and Dry frowned and said,
My lord has no intention of abandoning Oaton, but he wants to ensure Lady Terrence's safety first. Two of my fellow unicorn guard are trying to shore up the dam with ice bows, but their magic won't last. It's only going to buy us time.
Yes,
said Count Shining, giving Trixie and Cheerilee a mortified look.
I sent one runner to run Oaton, suggesting they evacuate, but he has not returned yet. The Lumber Guild is gathering tools to try and repair the dam and further barricade the river. As long as the storm continues, however, it is only a matter of time.
The Lumber Guild is helping?
Trixie repeated, surprised. She would have thought Sawdust would have taken the opportunity to get away. Then she frowned at her own thinking. Of course Sawdust wouldn't run. However much of a manipulative liar he was, Trixie had to remember he was, at least in his own mind, doing all this for his own sister and her foals. Sawdust didn't want to see Oaton destroyed any more than any pony else here did. As the thinking about him was a summons, Sawdust arrived on the scene, breathing heavily, followed by a dozen of his own lumber ponies, carrying various axes or saws. Trixie bristled upon seeing Sawdust, but it did spare her the trouble of having to track him down. He took in the scene with a quick glance, eyes lingering for a moment untarnished, though she didn't seem to notice. She was too busy practically trying to hide from her brother's line of sight behind Cheerilee.
Ah, I see you succeeded in pacifying the situation, Miss Trixie,
Sawdust said, looking calm and collected. He turned to Tarnas, voice turning soft.
Tarnas, are you all right?
Tarnas looked away from him, and Cheerilee glared at Sawdust, but Tarnas answered quickly.
I don't know, Sawdust. You tried to warn me about the cave, but I didn't listen, and...
Tarnas morosely looked toward Raindrops, and Sawdust calmly followed her gaze, staying relaxed, until his eyes spotted a bushel on Raindrops' back, and his calm mask slipped, eyes widening.
What is she doing here?
Trixie didn't miss the note of panic in Sawdust's voice, and neither did anypony else. Count Shiny gave Busto a surprised look, as if he was just now noticing the small filly for the first time as well.
A good question! Who is he? And why is he in such a state?
Tarnas made a soft sobbing sound, and started saying before Trixie could answer herself,
She got hurt by me. Lightning. I didn't mean for that to happen.
As far as Trixie recalled, the whole lightning thing was pretty intentional on Tarnas' part, but was willing to set that aside, because playing the blame game was low on the priority list at the moment. Not like there wasn't plenty of blame to go around at this point anyway. Sawdust was looking less than fully collected, as his lumber ponies were giving him odd looks as he approached Bushel, ignoring Raindrops' glare.
Her inverted horn has come into full growth, he said, a sad note joining the wavering panic. Tell me, was she directly exposed to a large burst of magic?
Trixie frowned, nodding.
The lightning she saved me from was more magic than natural. Her horn sucked it all in. You knew about her?
Since the incident last year, he said, eyeing Tarnas. You forgot, didn't you, Tarnas?
Tarnas wavered, shrinking back. She gave Bushel a look, paused, eyes gradually gaining recognition.
She was the one we found a year ago, isn't she? The one who wandered across my cave.
What is the meaning of this?
Count Shining sounded suddenly.
The Tarnest! How do you know Sawdust?
They've been in contact since the time the Lumber Guild was here a year ago, Trixie said flatly. Just about everything that happened back then was mostly Sawdust's plan. However, this is the first I'm hearing of Bushel having anything to do with that.
While Count Shining assured that Sawdust reached out a hoof to touch Bushel's form. Raindrops let him, but the look on her face said she was sorely tempted by both the anger she naturally felt and the intense pull toward violence of the negatively charged storm above to introduce his jaw to this colon in a most forceful and messy manner.
She wandered into the forest last year and found Tarnas' cave. I happened to be visiting Tarnas at the time, Sawdust said, turning to give Tarnas a look at the mare it turned away from. I had little option but to use a ritual I learned to alter her memory.
I'm a filly!
Cheerilee exclaimed, taking up a threatening step towards Sawdust.
Do you have any idea what kind of side effects that manner of magic can have?
Well, yes. I took precautionary measures to keep the spell as unobtrusive as possible. How do you know about memory spells? Hardly common knowledge for a schoolteacher, no?
Sawdust asked, looking surprised. Cheerilee's eyes narrowed dangerously as he continued to advance on Sawdust.
I've had some experience with such magic before. Experience enough to know it's not magic to use on any pony, let alone a filly with a still-developing mind.
Trixie nodded, giving Sawdust a cutting look.
It's illegal magic for a reason. How do you even know it? Those spells are not exactly the kind of thing you learned at a university.
Several of the Lumber Guild ponies have interposed themselves between Cheerilee and Sawdust, though many others were just confused and were muttering amongst themselves.
It's not important where I learned the ritual, Sawdust said, meaning Trixie and Cheerilee's angry looks. I have contacts and less scrupulous places of magic, and let's leave it at that. The fact that I'm confessing to using memory and spells at all should tell you how serious this matter is. Bushel needs to be treated as soon as possible. Using the memory-altering ritual last year, I discovered her condition, because her Orin partially ate the spell. She still remembered bits of what occurred in the forest, but more importantly, feeding it magic caused the Inverted Horde to start wanting to consume more.
But with no magic to eat, it started to feed on Bushel instead, said Cheerilee,
and the school teacher's fury only increased. She pushed right past the Lumber Guild ponies in her way and was right in Sawdust's face.
Of all the responsible, callous acts, I should smack you into next school year for doing that to a filly!
Your feelings are justified, said Sawdust, meeting Cheerilee's look while waving off his fellow Lumber Guild ponies with one hoof. At this point, I do not expect to escape punishment for my actions. Damage control is my priority now. My niece at the top of that list. Last year, Bushel went into a feverish coma as her horn tried to feed itself by taking magic straight from her own life force when no other magic was available. That is, until Trixie fed Bushel her own magic to pacify the horn. Trixie blinked.
I did? Wait, that's right! She said I cast a spell on her back then. How did you know I'd do that? I was completely drunk off my tail!
Sawdust looked at her, with a small, barely noticeable twist to the corner of his eye. Yes. Ugh, quite drunk. He shivered. Quite drunk. However, not so drunk that you were beyond suggestion. I knew of Bushel's condition, and that it could be treated, even temporarily, by directly feeding her horn magic. Before you had your conversation with my father, I let it slip to you that there was a sick filly in Oaton, and that she might be helped by having magic poured over her. Which is exactly what you did. Her horn consumed that magic, and it was enough to pacify the horn's needs. Sort of put it back to a dormant state. He looked at Bushel, at the glowing translucent horn on her forehead. Unfortunately, that is not an option now.
Why not?
Raindrops asked, voice heated.
We have to do something for her!
The problem is different, Sawdust explained. Her horn isn't starving. It's overcharged. Instead of feeding off of her in its a dangerously close state to simply exploding from having too much magic. Worse, if it was magic from the storm, then it's filled with the dark energy from the shrine. That energy has to be purged out of her. If not... He let that sentence unfinished, but every pony knew what that grave look on his face meant. Tarnus looked at the ground, her whole form trembling, eyes unfocused. Cheerilee was stony-faced, and Trixie had never seen her, save for the schoolteacher's eyes, which were emerald pools of fire, directed solely at Sawdust. Raindrops looked like she could chew a boulder in half for how tightly her teeth were gritted in the half-snarl. Count Shiny looked like a pony that had the proverbial sword hanging over his head, didn't know how to get out of the way. Most of the rest, the Coppercorn guards, and the Lumber Guild ponies all bore looks of confusion, worry, and agitation. Tenses sparked between all of them. Trixie realized if they didn't get focused on something positive, the effects of the storm might push these ponies over the edge before long.
That spell, Trixie said. Sawdust, you researched the spell to deal with the darkness in that shrine, right?
Sawdust nodded, eyeing her warily. A putrefaction spell, yes.
Will it also remove the dark magic from this Bushel's horn?
Sawdust cast his eyes upwards, pondering, though he didn't have long to think it over.
I believe it would, but she would have to be at the epicenter of the spell, which would prove dangerous considering the spell would also have to be cast at the shrine itself.
What's mine? Sister Sawdust, explain yourself! What is going on? What have you gotten my sister involved in?
Cal Shining was shaking in fury. And Trixie could tell his mood was bleeding into his guards. Cut and Dry had her magic wreathed around the hilt of her sword, and the other guards were tensing up, all of them radiating weapons with dark looks in their eyes.
Count shining copper coin, Trixie said, urgency in her voice. It would take too long to bring you up to speed on everything. There is a cave in the forest containing a shrine of some sort, which holds the remnant of some ancient evil. It's caused the storm above us, which, if you're feeling particularly cranky, it's partly to blame. Every pony more prone to anger, including your sister, who was living on top of that thing.
Count Shiny's eyes boggled, and he cast a nervous look up at the storm. Forks of green and violet lightning split across the dense layers of black clouds swirling above. No pony could mistake this for a natural storm by this point.
You knew about this, Sawdust, and you let my sister get defensive with this?
He waved a hoof frantically at the sky, eyes wide.
I am placing you under arrest for endangering the lives of everybody here with reckless negligence!
Sawdust sighed, raising a hoof to forestall his lumber ponies, who had started to step forward with anger in their eyes, readying saws and axes, while the coppercorn guards started to draw swords. He gave them a hard look and shook his head before turning to Count Shining. Arrest me as you will, but you have bigger responsibilities than punishing me. If the dam breaks, you lose everything. And if she, he nodded at Bustle, does not recover, then I lose the reason I started all this to begin with. Count Shining looked as if he could be chewing through iron bars, for as hard as his jawline was set, as he said,
So be it. What do we do then?
He sounded like he was spitting nails, dust agreeing with sawdust. Trixie brought out the spell-licking wand she had taken from the ice wall earlier.
Count Shining, I return this to you. Can your unicorns create a strong enough ice wall together to maintain the dam?
Count Shining frowned. That looked to cut and dry. The guardsmare took the wand in her telekinetic aurora, giving Trixie a bit of a stink eye by saying,
Not for very long. Once like this, they allow stronger spells to be cast, though linking a unicorn's magic with another's. But all it does is double the strain on our horns to do so. We exhaust ourselves to the point of overchanneling in no time, trying to do a second wall of that size.
Trixie frowned. They looked at Sawdust.
Last year, when I and the Fire Drakes destroyed the previous time, you and Mayor Sheaf were able to...
He cut her off before she could finish, shaking his head. The barrier spell Sheaf and I created was enough to redirect the water that time, only because it was just the dam itself collapsing. This storm is causing the entire river to overflow. The storm is what we have to stop, Trixie. Everything else is just buying time towards that end.
Then get your ponies on it!
Raindrops snapped.
All this talking is wasting time! You two!
She down to hoof at Sawdust, then at Count Shining.
Stop arguing and get your ponies working together to barricade that river! Me, Trixie, and Charlie will deal with this storm!
Sawdust clicked his head. Ignoring for the present how you three will do that. There's a problem. I don't think we have enough ponies between myself and the Count to stop the river. We need dozens of sets of hooves to have that much of a chance.
Then you'll hire them!
Every pony turned their heads toward the south. Coming through the murky rain was a cluster of ponies, drenched to the bone, but walking with determined gaits. Trixie soon recognized the faces of the Oaton ponies, and at the head of the group was Sheath himself, his wife Picturesque at her side. There was a slight stirring among the Oaton ponies, seeing the basilisk amid the cluster of copper-coin family guards. Hovington Lumber Guild ponies, and the three elements of harmony, but Sheaf didn't break stride as he came up to the unusual gathering. Picturesque came up as well, and Trixie didn't miss the look she gave Sawdust, one of both guilt and hope. Of course, that look vanished the second she saw Bustle and gasped,
Bustle!
Raindrops was quick to bring the foal over to her parents, and Trixie and Cheerilee both joined her as Picturesque gathered up to Philly, immediately taking her over. She gave Trixie a sidelong glance in the meantime, saying,
Don't waste time on the details. Just tell me if you can help my daughter like you did before.
Trixie hesitated, but nodded firmly.
I'll help her whatever it takes, but it won't be as simple as before. Sawdust knows of a spell that can help, but getting it won't be easy. And we have other problems besides.
She flew out a huff of steaming air from his nostrils.
Then we deal with the problems. That's why we're here.
A round of loud cries of agreement went up from the Oaton ponies, though this does seem to make the copper coin guards and the lumber ponies tense as Sheath approached Sawdust and Count Shining. Trixie took a quick look around, seeing Raindrops stay close to Picturesque and Bustle.
Cheerilee was quietly talking with Tarnas, while Tarnas herself was looking nervously at the Oaton ponies. In the distance, Trixie heard the groaning of wood from the dam, but also saw the telltale glow of magic amid the darkness. The unicorns were there where it does need to hold on a little longer. Hopefully, Oaton's ponies show up all meant that help was here. Trixie joined Chief just in time to hear him address the other two leaders.
Sadus, shut up and listen! You too can't! She said in a stony tone. Pissarus came clean to me. She told me everything.
Sawdust.
Right now, I don't care about your schemes. We'll sort that out later. Say to you, Kent, I don't give a single bit about your reasons for doing what you did. Your runner got word about to us about the dam. Meaning right now, ponies' lives and hoes are in danger. So me and my folk are here to help. Had to bow read half of them into agreeing. If we could all feel this storm, I ain't natural. But we're here. So let's get to drama and fix this sun-cursed dam already!
Sawdust and Count Shiny exchanged looks. There was apprehension in their eyes, a lack of trust. Trixie couldn't let that lack of trust undo the only chance they had been getting through this, stepping between them and catching both their looks.
If Oaton's ponies can offer help, then all either of you have done is cause them grief. Then the two of you can work together with them. Your ponies don't have to become fast friends, but cooperation has to start with some pony taking the other pony's hoof when it's offered!
Silence stretched for a few seconds, but finally Count Shining said, bowing his head to Sheath,
"It doesn't take a lot of help, Mayor Sheath."
Sawdust nodded in agreement, turning to one of his ponies.
"Flapjack, get every pony to the dam. Organize the teams to include Oaton ponies. Make sure every pony knows how to work in full cooperation with them."
The red lumber stallion nodded quietly and ran off. And soon, Sheath had sent most of the Oaton ponies along to go assist in repairing the dam and barricading the river. Count Shining sent his guards away to assist as well, except for Cut and Dry, who assisted to remain at his side. That left the leaders and the element bearers in the lumberyard with a tense mask list, a nervous Tarnas, and Pissarette still holding the unconscious bushel close.
"Sheath, I..."
Sawdust began, but was silenced by the larger stallion, shooting him a glare.
"No. No excuses. Not while my daughter's in this state and my home is about to be washed away. Tell me what can be done. Nothing more. Not a single word more. Or, I swear by Luna's moon in the heavens, I'll give on to you what I feel right now and knock your block off so hard you'll get to kiss the sun before you come back down to Equestria!"
Sawdust cleared his throat and gulped, levitating out his journal from underneath his bowler cap and floating over Trixie.
"My journal has the details of half a spell to counter the cause of the storm, and save Bushel. The other half of the spell is in Canterlot. We must take Bushel to the forest, where there is a shrine and a cave that is the source of the current problem. Somehow, a way must be found to get the other half of the spell from Canterlot, while we both confront the darkness in the shrine and keep the river from overflowing and wiping Oaton out."
Trixie held the journal close to try and keep it dry, despite the rain, and said,
"The only thing I could think of to get the rest of the spell is to send a Pegasus. Count Shining, can any of your guards volunteer?"
The Count shook his head.
"The only Pegasus in my employ has run afoul of a cockatrice's stare."
Cut and Dry tilted her head questioningly and pointed a hoof at Raindrops.
"But what about her? Surely a Pegasus is as lyrically built, yet femininely light, as her could make the journey."
The guards bearer seemed to realize that he was staring at Raindrops, who was in turn giving Cut and Dry a weird look, and looked away.
"Just pointing out that she is a Pegasus."
Raindrops looked at her wings, frowning.
"I could try, but Canterlot isn't a short fly away, and my speed isn't my strong point as a flyer."
"Pony feels closer," said Cheerilee. "We can get the others, with the elements of harmony."
Trixie was quick to respond.
"The thought crossed my mind, but there's a few problems with that notion. One, Lyra and Carrot Top would have to get here on hoof, which would take even longer than Raindrops flying to Canterlot. Two, we have no idea if we can activate the elements at will. Last time, they activated against Corona on their own. They might activate against this thing, or they might not. We wouldn't know until it was too late to change their minds. Third, we don't know if the elements of harmony would also fix Bushel, as well as defeating the darkness in that shrine. Finally, fourth, I want Raindrops to contact Princess Luna. With the Princess, Raindrops can be teleported right back here, and if the putrefaction spell fails, Luna might be able to finish what we couldn't."
Trixie didn't like planning for failure. As Ed suggested, he liked confidence he succeed. But this situation called for it. In spades.
Raindrops didn't look convinced.
I still don't like this. It means I won't be here while you're walking into danger. Plus, slow. Even a fast Pegasus would take...
Raindrops frowned, crunching the numbers in her head.
We're talking at least 2 hours. One way, and that's if I was going at rainbow dash speeds. My pace. It'd be twice as that. Easy. It'd be morning by the time I even got to the palace.
I know, but I'm not seeing any other options. We need the other half of that spell. You might not be fast, but you're faster than our next fastest option, which is walking!
Trixie said, voice raising slightly as her anxiety peaked, all too aware that every second counted. Raindrops looked at her wings. Trixie could see doubt playing across the mare's features. Trixie took a step forward, intending to give encouraging words. But before she could, Cut and Dry spoke up.
I can help!
At every pony turning to look at the crust-colored guard's mail, she visibly stiffened, agitated playing over her stance as she looked over Raindrops.
It's my special talent, you see. I've always liked this guy and... Okay, it's not important how I got it, but my cutie mark...
In lieu of saying it, she levitated up her guard's uniform enough to display the mark on her flank. It was a pair of white wings spreading from a puffy cloud. Cut and Dry quickly covered the mark again, a rosy tint on her muzzle.
Flight! I love flying! Wouldn't be able to, either, if not for my Lord Count Shining giving me access to his family's library, where I learned a flight spell.
Trixie made a small sound. She had heard flight spells. From what she understood, they were difficult to perform and maintain. The sky was the domain of the Pegasi, and getting into it any other way was no simple process. While it wasn't unheard of that Earth ponies or unicorns could be enamored with the idea of flight, Trixie didn't see how this could help.
Okay, so you can cast a flight spell. You wouldn't be much faster than Raindrops, though, and I doubt you'd have the energy to maintain the spell all the way to Canterlot.
You're right,
Kundari said, though her tone suggested she rather detested admitting to Trixie was right.
However, I can cast a spell on other ponies, including Lady Raindrops.
Lady Raindrops?
Trixie quirked an eyebrow.
Would that work?
Cut and Dry nodded firmly.
I've done it once or twice before for Pegasi among the Count's guards. My flight spell, when placed upon the Pegasus, grants them an extra set of wings, more maneuverability, and flight endurance, and most importantly in this case, speed. It will make her a faster flyer.
Well then, let's not waste any time, growled Chief. Cast your spell, and let's be on about saving my daughter and my town!
In short order, Cut and Dry approached Raindrops, both mares seeming a little nervous at the proximity. Trixie didn't know what that was about, but plans were in motion, so no time to think about it. Soon, Raindrops was wrapped up in a cocoon of iridescent white and blue magical energy. Cut and Dry looked strained, but not as much as Trixie would have thought, casting a spell like that. Special talents did cause such a difference in spellcasting ability with certain spells. In moments, after a flash of light, Raindrops found herself floating in the air, not only being held aloft by her own wings, but by an additional pair of gossamer wings that had space between them. The wings had a prismatic coloring, and were translucent, and shaped much like the wings of an actual Pegasus.
Hey!
Raindrops sounded naturally surprised.
This actually feels natural!
The spell does that,
Kundry said, panting a little but smiling. An expression Trixie thought looked distinctly out of place on the guard's mirror.
I've pushed as much of my magic as I dare into extending the spell. It should last 4 hours, enough to get you to Canterlot.
Raindrops noted, an expression hardening into one determination.
Thank you for this. I owe you.
Cut and Dry coughed, waving a hoof.
It's nothing. Go, the clock is ticking on that spell.
Right!
Raindrops fixed Trixie and Cheerilee with a serious look.
I'll be back as fast as I can. Both of you, don't do anything crazy until I get back. I mean it.
So, it's okay for us to do something crazy when you get back?
Asked Cheerilee with a small smile, trying to bring a little humor to an otherwise desperate situation. Raindrops shook her head.
Trying to be serious here, Cheerilee, but yeah, just be careful. All of you.
Same to you.
Said Trixie, looking at the storm above worriedly. Raindrops took note of Trixie's worry and put on a confident, if faint, grin.
Strong flyer, remember?
Raindrops turned and narrowed her eyes at the sky.
This storm isn't going to stop me.
Here, Sawdust said, carefully removing pages from his journal and floating them out to Raindrops. These pages have notes I have put down for where the spell is located. It's in a researcher's document complication in Canterlot University's archives, the section on ancient equestrian civilization. Raindrops held the pages in her mouth for a moment until Cut and Dry floated over to her, a small pouch to tuck the pages into that. Raindrops secured one onto her legs. Then, giving her friends one last nod, Raindrops flapped her wings, both natural and magical, and a powerful double buzz rocketed up to the sky. Cut and Dry hadn't been exaggerating. The extra pair of wings was doing wonders for Raindrop's speed. It took less than half a minute for Raindrops to vanish into the darkness, and Trixie could hope for her friend's safe and fast journey. She turned her attention to Bushel and Picturesque. The older mare looked at Trixie, a whirlpool of emotions on her face. Trixie felt taken aback by that look. Picturesque didn't look as she could decide whether to hate herself or erupt into anger. And when she spoke, it was a disturbingly quiet tone.
Miss Trixie, tell me, how did my daughter's condition get this bad?
Trixie kept from glancing at Tarnished, who had lowered her head so far her muzzle was practically buried in mud. Tarnished looked utterly miserable. Cheerilee was back at her side, a hoof covering the other mare's withers. Trixie opened her mouth to answer, but she cut her off, looking at his wife.
We can learn the details after this is done, Pick,
she said, as he gave Tarnished a suspicious, narrowed-eyed look. We'll sort out responsibility and punishments when, and only when, every pony is safe.
Trixie, Sawdust, let's have a look at this spell.
Sawdust noted, his horn glowing as he cast a shield spell that covered them in a thin blanket of energy that kept the rain off the group. He then floated out his journal and levitated over so it floated between him, Trixie, and Sheath. Cut and Dry, though looking tired from casting her flight spell, joined them to examine the spell that Sawdust displayed. Trixie had seen these notes already, but not really had a chance to examine them. She didn't understand magic very well in written form, however. Sheath, looking at the geometric patterns, scribbled notations, and arcane writings spread across several pages, said,
You had to translate this into modern equestrian, didn't you?
Yes. This spell was conceived of by ponies from 1,000 years ago, so the syntax of their arcane writings differ from ours. However, the spell translated well into contemporary methods, and I applied several modern theories to enhance its potential effects, said Sawdust.
I don't understand, Cut and Dry said, frowning. You said this is half a spell, but it looks like a complete ritual to me.
Trixie was quick to jump on this one, familiar with the concept as she was, being an illusionist.
That's because it's a compound spell. Illusions utilize the concept often. You know how illusions can affect multiple senses, sight being the most common. Well, an illusion can have added effects, like sound, taste, even texture. But at its core, it's still the same spell. That's a compound spell. This ritual here is the initial effect. It can be cast and maintained on its own. But it's only meant to be half of a whole. Sawdust! What does this first half actually do?
It's a barrier of sorts, says Sawdust. My specialty is abjuration, after all. The barrier is special, however, in that it draws in a certain kind of energy, specifically negative energy. Then it contains it in a concentrated spot for as long as the pony's casting it can hold the spell.
Pounies? Asked Seath.
Yes. This spell ritual requires at least 3 unicorns to maintain the barrier, Sawdust said solemnly, giving Seath a sidelong look, then at Tarnished, who was standing outside at the conversation.
Trixie blinked at sudden realization.
That's what you were planning on doing! She blurted. You intended to use the spell against this thing in the shrine, which sheathed its harness's help from the start!
Sawdust bobbed his head in a nod.
I rather botched that aspect of my plan. I thought that I had time, that Tarnished would resist the influence of the shrine, and that Picturesque could convince you onto my way of thinking, Sheath. If only there was a little more time. Then together we could purge the darkness, then see Oaton built into something glorious. I suppose I shall settle for dealing with the shrine.
Sheath closed his eyes, sighing. Why didn't you just come to me about this to begin with? Why the deception? Why any of this shit, Sawdust?
If I had, would you have been cooperative? I know you, Sheath.
You could teach Granite to how to be properly stubborn. You never agreed to my plans for Oaton. Not if you, I just come out to you with my plans. Old friend. She spat, grunting. Don't call me friend! I just want to save my daughter in town. We have enough unicorns to do this spell, right?
Well, Trixie said, here's myself. You, Mayor Seif, then Sawdust, tarnished and cut and dry. That's five unicorns, so I say we're set.
Sawdust gave her a flat stare. After all you've done this night, you feel you have enough magic to maintain a ritual like this? For the hours it will take for your friend to return for the second half? Trixie gulped. Her horn was feeling the strain. Between the fight with Tarnished and using the spell to communicate with the Basilisk, she felt as if she had nearly run herself dry. However, Trixie felt she had to be here for this. As a representative of Night Court, as the bearer of element magic, and as the mayor who made a promise to a certain filly to see this through until Oaton was safe. No, regardless of how tired Trixie felt, or how difficult this final spell would be, she intended to be there.
I can handle it. The question is, who will the other two unicorns be?
Cut and Dry took a step forward, but Count Shining held up a hoof, holding her back.
My lord?
The rose-colored unicorn asked, frowning.
You don't need to work out with the others on the dam, Cut and Dry, Count Shining said. You are far more familiar with the Ice Wall spell. Dealing with the shrine thing will be pointless if we lose Oaton anyway. You are remaining here.
She's moved to Trixie's side, giving him a firm-eyed look. My daughter has to be at the center of the spell. There's no way it's a Taurus I'm not going to be there for her. I'm going. Taurus took a step forward as well, starting to say,
I should do something that as well.
Trixie and Cheerilee both said,
No!
At practically the same instant, but Cheerilee was the quickly one to explain in a comforting tone, rubbing Taurus's withers.
Tarn. No pony can ask you to go back in there and face that thing in its lair. But I should be the one with the unicorns in there,
Tarnus said, gaining some of the fire back in her eyes that had been buried under pain and guilt.
And everything along is my fault. I have to do my part to set things right.
You will, Tarn, said Cheerilee. Remember, me and you had to go find some of those animal friends of yours to help with the dam. That will be enough. You don't have to do more than that, Tarn. Least of all, putting yourself at risk of this dark force getting into your head again.
You and I,
Tarn said softly. Cheerilee blinked.
Huh?
Tarn didn't really smile. It was just a small, barely guessed will-o'-wisp of a smile. But Tarn looked at Cheerilee and said,
You and I, not me and you. Aren't you supposed to be a teacher?
Cheerilee blinked and then laughed, hugging her friend to her chest. Sawdust, looking uncomfortable with the scene, twitched one of his ears, but he quickly gained a calm look. In any case, I think we spent enough time planning. I shall be the third unicorn. I should have enough magical energy to fill in the role, and you, Sheath, should be pretty fresh. We could make up for the strain that I'll otherwise put on Miss Trixie.
I'm going too, said Piscaress suddenly, fiercely, as she held her daughter close. If Bustle must be there, I'm not leaving her. That won't disrupt the spell, will it?
Shada shook his head. No. You can hold your daughter the entire time, if you so wish. But do understand, the more minds the shrine has to affect, the greater chances it will influence one of us enough to disrupt the ritual. I'll have to shield all of our minds. Right now, the storm's influence merely makes us more prone to anger. But at the heart of the shrine, where the ritual must be done, its influence will be much stronger. We all must be prepared for that. There was a moment of silence as all the ponies present looked to each other, apprehension and tension filling the space between them. Trixie was the first to take in a deep breath, step forward, and put her hoof out in the middle of the group.
We can't be separated in this.
She looked at him each in turn.
Together, we're going to save Oaton, Bushel, and every pony else here. This thing is going to try to divide us, to prey on the mistrust and anger. Whatever grievances we have, whoever feels wronged by another, put it from your mind! We go in there. We do so with one mind, one purpose, and we don't let anything break that!
Seath looked at his wife and daughter, Bushel still unconscious and breathing shallowly. Then he looked between Count Shining, Tardus, and Sawdust with eyes gleaming with anger. But he was the first to take in, and let out a deep breath and step forward, putting his hoofs over Trixie's.
Together,
he said. Sawdust cut his head to one side, a wry smile creeping onto his face. You still have something of a dramatic streak, Miss Trixie. But I can't argue with your words. He stepped up and put himself onto the pile. Together it is.
Count Shining, for a second, seemed taken aback. Perhaps even ashamed he wasn't the one leading this chain of events. But after a moment, he took hold of himself, and with a firm nod at Cut and Dry, both he and the guardsmare put their hose onto the others.
I will not mistake with my representative's qualities as a noble lay anymore, even if I lose that noble title,
he said firmly, no sign of a stutter to be heard.
So I and Cut and Dry will not be going with you. We will be fighting alongside every pony from Oaton and the Lumber Guild. I surrender my family name. You will have a home to return to.
Cut and Dry glanced briefly at Trixie, dislike still clear in the rust-coated mare's eyes. But she nodded at her sword lord's words and put her heart firmly onto the others. Cheerilee looked down, then at Tarnus, and gave the other mare an encouraging nod, gently leading Tarnus over to the group. Tarnus had the look of a mare who was adrift at sea in the middle of a storm, reaching her hoof hesitantly toward the others like it was a lifeline. Settling onto her hoof, suddenly, was Piscaress. The two mares' eyes met for a second. Tarnus's surprise and guilt filled. Piscaress encouraging, and Trixie noted forgiving. Had Piscaress put together who was responsible for Bush's contention? As he had, Trixie was glad to see Piscaress was willing to give Tarnus the benefit of the doubt. Cheerilee's own hoof came to rest atop of the pile, completing the group. Trixie to Cheerilee shared a smile. Then Trixie looked at the assembled ponies. She felt like she ought to say something else here. Wasn't the hero supposed to give some final, rousing, inspiring thing to say before every pony leads into the breach? Her still mare's mind conjured a dozen different grand turns of phrase about facing the darkness, etc. But nothing really fit what she was feeling at that moment. Thoughts of heroism were, quite frankly, nowhere in her mind. Her thoughts were consumed with one thing alone. Saving in the filly that had, in turn, saved her. The forest had been difficult to navigate before when Trixie had chased Tarnus into it. But now, with the raging storm overhead, Trixie was troubled just seeing in front of her own muzzle. The wind screamed in violent howls through the thickly clustered branches, and streams of water pelted the group of ponies marching through the forest relentlessly. It would have been all but impossible to find their way to the cave, if not for the rather sizable guide.
Sawdust,
Trixie heard she say. You're certainly can trust this thing. Trixie winced slightly at the massive basculus leading the party through the forest, turned its head and hissed in a low, menacing way. The seat just as she thought it'd keep its mouth shut. Sawdust, trotting just ahead of Trixie, looked back at his one-time friend and gave a wider smile. As certain as I can be, considering the circumstances, replied the Lumber Guild leader, putting a hoof onto his bowler cap as a particularly strong gust of wind nearly blew it off. He paused, as did the rest of the group, as they waited for the basculus to bat aside a tree that had fallen in their path. I've seen Tarnus play with these creatures like they were large-scale covered kittens. If he says this one will lead us to the cave safely and convince his mate not to eat us, I'm willing to hold confidence in her. That got Trixie curious. And she needed something to distract her from the growing sense of impending doom that was pressing on in her with every step they took. Despite the blanket of the mind shield, she could feel the building anxiety she was certain wasn't natural. The whispers she heard last time that she was in the forest were back, muffled as she was being heard through a door, but remaining an unceasing background noise clawing at the corners of her awareness, getting louder the deeper they went.
How did you get Tarnus to trust you at all anyway?
Trixie asked Sawdust.
She ran away from her family to get all back to nature in this forest, and you're a lumber pony. Not exactly any common ground between you.
Sawdust huffed out what must have been a laugh. Piscaress mostly. That, and we shared at least one thing in common. We both had issues with family. Different issues, true. But the fact remained, it was good for both of us to have some pony to talk about our frustrations. Certainly, she wasn't keen on my profession, but in time, I was able to convince her that it was not my intention to destroy the forest, or set the homes with her animal friends. Which is true, whether you believe me or not. I don't want to destroy this forest. This place would be king to Oaton's revival. Chief snorted again. Oaton's revival. As if you understand what Oaton needs. As if we're dying. You are.
She's let out a loud growl. And Piscarets put a hoof on his shoulder. To which he gave a sharp look. Eyes flashing in anger. Though that look quickly faded as he fell on the sight of his daughter. He sighed and taking in deep breaths before saying,
"Not having this argument again with you, Saldos."
Slowly, almost subtly, he and Piscarets hung back a few extra paces while they continued to trudge through the forest. For a few minutes, the only sounds to be heard being the thunder of the storm and the crashing steps of the basilisk, and the barely perceptible wash of incoherent whispers. Trixie licked her now dry lips and pulled up next to Sawdust.
"What do you mean?" she asked in a quiet tone. "What about Oaton?"
Sawdust kept his eyes forward. "Just what I said. Oaton is dying. Slowly, year by year, generation by generation. Their population has steadily declined over time. Inevitably, if they continue as they are, Oaton will become just a ghost town. What few inhabitants are left, little more than hermits. Until they, too, die off."
Trixie grimaced, the whispers in her head suddenly gaining a sharp clarity that she could feel pressing against around her consciousness.
"He's lying to make himself sound better. Just trying to gain your sympathy. You're smarter than he is. Better than he is. He's a bad guy here. You shouldn't be trusting him. This ritual must be a trap. He's leading you into a..."
Trixie shook her head. "No! These were not her thoughts!" She took in a calming breath, forcing away the aberrant thoughts, trying to push her way back into her head. Sawdust was now looking at her with unreadable eyes.
"Why are you so convinced they can't survive on their own?" Trixie asked. "They've done all right from what I've seen."
"Oaton is just too small. Not enough new blood to keep the pool diverse. Each generation, there are just fewer foals to be born. Hence, fewer ponies to work the fields. Gradually, they've lost farms as families have peered out to single, old individuals that are all that remain. This isn't just my idea, Miss Trixie. The reason Seeds gets so angry when I bring this up is because he's the one who first realized that Oaton needed to change. That's why he left to go to Canterlot and become educated. To save Oaton. But he failed. He met my sister. Fell in love. Had a foal with her. And in doing so, completely forgot why he left Oaton to begin with. Moving back here to raise his family."
Trixie was no expert. But Sawdust's words did make a sort of sense. Despite there being whispers in her head saying he was an untrustworthy, sneaky, oily bastard, she ought to stab in the throat with her horn before his sudden, inevitable betrayal. She suppressed a shiver. The whispers were getting worse.
"It's stupid,"
Trixie found herself saying under her breath, causing Sawdust to look at her glance. Trixie rubbed her head with a hoof, trying to tune out the whisper.
Just you and Sheath. Sorry, can't think straight. Lord's not good right now. Be better if you, him, Count Shiny, every pony, all got together and decided how to make Oaton better. Now, with all the, you know, massively illegal actions certain ponies, namely you and Count Shining, have done. It's just stupid! The ponies most suited to fixing things are going to end up in jail, and the best thing I could do is... what's the phrase you use?
Damage control? He provided.
Yes, that! Trixie said burly. I want there to be a way for every pony to come out of this for the better!
You shouldn't trouble yourself over it, Sawdust said with a resigned note. Myself and Count Shining have dug our own graves. I will find mine comfortable enough to lay down in, if I can do with some assurance that my family is safe and my employees' needs are looked after. I merely regret that Oaton will never live up to his potential as I and she dreamed of during those days he, my sister, and I were together.
The stallion sounded gently regretful. Tracy looked back at Sheath and Picturesque, who were remaining far above if they couldn't hear what she and Sawdust were saying over the noise of the storm. She remembered the journal entries she read, and could almost see the three of these ponies together at Canterlot University, enjoying an evening meal in some cluttered dorm room. The space between them now was painfully obvious, and Trixie had enough of it. They weren't even to the cave yet, and they were only pulling apart.
Sawdust, go talk to them, she said.
He gave her a sudden look, his eyes opening a little wider, his ears slightly drawing back. I don't think Sheep wants to talk. Trixie cut him off and pointed the hoof back.
Talk to them both! Talk to your friend and your sister! Talk about the good times. Talk about the bad. Talk about Philly. Talk about anything. But talk to them!
He blinked at her. In fact, they all were. Because Trixie had stopped walking, hence bringing the group to a halt. Sawdust gulped visibly, and nodded slowly, turning back to where Picturesque and Seath were, leaving Trixie up front with the basculus. Over the storm, Trixie couldn't hear them, but she saw Sawdust begin to arcily begin a conversation. Sheath looked like he would rather chew rocks than talk, and Picturesque looked guilty and worried. But slowly, Trixie saw them all relax. Sheath's stony visage gradually softened, if only just. Picturesque's guilt slowly melted, and Sawdust's awkwardness, step by step, became eagerness. Soon, the three were sharing a quiet talk, and Trixie heard the occasional laugh from the three. Trixie smiled, shaking her head.
If they'd only done that to start with,
she muttered under her breath, as he heard the basculus rumble a soft growl that might have been agreement, or a simple indication he was getting hungry. She really hoped for the former. The cold wind coursing through the forest began to batter even harder, freezing the ponies up through their coats. Trixie was hearing whispers now almost incessantly, and Trixie employed the most advanced, sophisticated techniques he knew how to carry them.
La 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 la, not listening, la 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 la, can't hear you!
She repeated, mantra-like, while tucking her head's brim down over her ears and packing a cough into her eardrums. It didn't work nearly as well as she would have liked. The voices were like slick oil, slipping past conventional means of tuning them out.
No, I can leave her voices, asked Picturesque, shaking her head. Brother, I thought you sealed in our minds.
I did, Saunders replied, tilting his head at the surrounding forest. Most of this is actual sound made by the wind, manipulated into this cacophony. The seals are just a buffer, sister. They should hold, but the strain will be greater once we reach the shrine, which should be soon, it appears. His words were brought on by the basculus tromping out into the clearing, surrounding the hillhock that bore the cavern mouth. The cave's entrance was as foreboding and as Trixie remembered from the previous night, like a gaping, black wound in the glassy hillhock. Trixie suppressed a gulp. Every instinct she had told her that she did not want to walk in there. In fact, the moment the ponies entered the clearing, a blast of wind assaulted them, almost strong enough to force even the sizable sheep to take back a step. And Trixie actually did have to stagger back, not just from the force of wind, but the wall of voices that hit them. The maddening tackle of hundreds of shrill whispers, incomprehensibly speaking of death and doom as if another step were taken. Trixie, despite everything, nearly succumbed to instinct to turn and flee then and there, but one glass of Bustle's form on Picturesque's back, the filly letting out a soft moan in her unconscious state, forced away any thought of running. Anger flared. Determination solidified, and Trixie straightened her hat, stepping forward.
Sadus, what is this thing? You must know something, said Sheath, looking at the cave entrance with wide eyes, but a strong stance, as if he was squaring against a physical foe.
Less than you would imagine, Sawdust said, shading his eyes with a bowler cap against the slashing rain. It's old. It feeds off our worst emotions, and it was brought here by Oaton's founding ancestors. She threw in a soft breath.
You're saying this is our fault?
Sada sighed. No. It's the fault of ponies centuries dead, Sheath. Luckily us, other ponies, also centuries dead, researched the spell we're about to use to undo the mistake of your forebears.
This changes nothing, Sheath said. Oaton's traditions still stand, even if they have unfortunate origins.
Stubborn, Sawdust said, lips compressing into a thin frown. I used to see you as a visionary, Sheath. Where did that vision of a thriving, progressive Oaton go?
I sell it for the fullest dream it was. I had a family to raise. I had to return to my home.
And abandon your convictions to change that home into something better?
No, I merely learned to raise my family that the home I thought was too stifling was in fact an honest, safe place for my foals to grow up. It didn't need the chains.
Oh, certainly. If all your foals ever wanted to be were farmers.
Slave! Brother! Please, both of you, stop!
Pitskeres said, her own eyes staring into the cave mouth. One hoof reaching back to gently stroke Bushel's mane.
We can't argue now.
The two stallions looked at her, and then at each other. They both ceased their arguing, but the silence between them spoke volumes. Trixie heaved out a sigh. She supposed it was too much to hope for that a brief talk would be enough to mend fences that had been broken years ago. But they needed to start somewhere. The basilisk had approached the cave and let out a trumpeting call, lowering his head to look inside. Trixie watched as seconds passed, trotting closer. She backpedaled as fast as, bursting from the shadows of the cave mouth, the smaller basilisk came out, its roar ringing louder than the howls of wind and crashes of thunder from the storm. The male basilisk was frothing at the mouth, its eyes wide and wild. Trixie found herself unable to turn away, but those eyes fixed right on her. She felt her own body go rigid as stone started to crawl up her legs. She felt her half moving on its own, pulling down over her eyes. She noticed the white glow of sawdust magic on her hat. The stallion was using his magic to pull her own hat over her eyes, just like she had in her brief scuffle with him. Breaking the lion's sight with the male basilisk stuffed the petrification, though Trixie was still too stunned to move. She didn't have to, however, as she felt a titanic crash that knocked her hooves. Pulling her hat off her face, she looked to see the larger female basilisk had wrestled her smaller mate to the ground and was holding the male down. The male's eyes lessened slightly, but it was still slightly struggling in the female's grasp, its yellow eyes bloodshot. She held Trixie up and eyed the two predatory lizards warily.
What's going wrong with the smaller one? I thought that Terrence Mayor said these creatures were resistant to the Shrine's influence or some such.
Trixie gave him a thankful nod and brushed herself off.
Resistant, not immune. Let's get in there fast. I don't think we have a lot of time left.
Not one of them looked remarkably eager to pass by the clearly enraged and possibly insane basilisk. But at least the far larger female seemed to have her mate well in its claw. As Trixie and the others trotted by, Trixie saw the female basilisk lower its head to her mate's and started making hissy sounds that were incredibly soft-sounding, coming from something that could challenge an Ursa Minor for sheer mass. Trixie, despite seeming it just a little crazy, stopped and nodded to the basilisk.
Thank you for showing us the way, and sorry about your mate's current natural state. Hopefully, what we're about to do in there will fix all of this.
The basilisk grumbled a noise that could have meant anything, but Trixie chose to take it as encouragement. She, Sheath, Sawdust, and Piscaress stood at the precipice of the cave's entrance, inky blackness stretching out over her. Taking a shuddering breath, Trixie adjusted her hat so her horn was exposed and lit it up, her blue magical light shining into the gloom. Her light was joined by Sawdust's white and Sheath's yellow, illuminating the less than Trixie thought the three unicorn light spells should. When Trixie took the first step inside, she felt a chill that didn't have anything to do with the rain. Picturesque actually shivered, flicking her tail so it covered her daughter protectively. Sheath noted and stepped closer to her, putting a hoof over her own withers and their foal. She looked a little surprised for a second, then leaned in close and nuzzled him. Sheath returned to Jester after only a moment's hesitation. Sawdust stood apart from them, looking uncomfortable. Trixie, a few steps into the cave, was shining her horn straight ahead, resisting the urge to look around too much. She knew as she started swinging her light around and made the shadows around her look like they were moving even more than they already did. Slowly, the others filed in behind her. This front area of the cave had enough of a ceiling that Trixie could easily see the basilisk's lair here, though the ceiling hung with thick vines and roots from the hill above. The cave floor was running with water, but fortunately, the land sloped toward the entrance, so the cave was in no danger of flooding. The oblong, oval cavern had a relatively smooth floor, and as the ponies went in deeper, they became enfolded by the dark, the unicorn lights only providing a small pool of visibility to move by.
Slaith, said Pitcheress, this is officially the worst night you've ever taken me out.
She's last was dry. Not really a time for humor, Pig.
Exactly, said Sawdust. This may be the best time for it. Any positive emotion will help.
If you're starting to tell jokes, Sawdust, any positive emotion I've got going toward you is going to instantly vanish, said Sheath.
Trixie's nervousness only increased as he realized now that they had entered the cave. The whispers he had been trying to worm their way into her mind during the trek across the forest hadn't increased, but instead had abruptly vanished. So he expected them to get worse, being inside the cave. Sawdust had suggested as much would happen. Cassie saw Sawdust's eye with her own. She saw the Lumber Guild leader nod. So he noticed it too.
What's all this stuff on the walls?
Asked Sheath, shining his horn toward one of the smooth stone walls of the cave. Trixie approached, adding her light, and gulped.
Strange lettering, strings and strings of it, spread over the walls in fiery, web-like patterns.
Trixie didn't recognize the style of writing, but that wasn't too surprising to her. Her studies with Princess Luna didn't cover ancient evil writings. Probably wasn't high on the princess's list of important topics to cover.
Probably made by the founders of Oaton, said Sawdust. These ponies still worship the entity the shrine was meant to venerate. Who knows what kind of rituals they conducted here?
She looked like he chewed something sour.
Makes my head hurt looking at it. I'm starting to think collapsing this cave would be an excellent idea.
Couple of house-sized lizards might take issue with that, said Trixie, as he started trotting toward the back of the cave.
Will Bushel really be safe, brother?
Pinterest asked, looking worriedly to Philly.
She's getting warmer.
Let me see,
Trixie said, coming over and leaning over Bushel. The little yellow filly was breathing its small, shallow breaths, seeming faster than what Trixie had seen earlier. The inverted horn was still mostly an aura, a condensed magical energy in horn shape, but Trixie could now see washes of shadow flowing over the magical light, like oil in a clear pool. Trixie gulped, using her magical sight for a moment to examine things more closely. She swore under her breath.
What is it?
Pinterest's voice was sharp with fear.
The writing,
Trixie said past conceit.
It's got negative energy flowing through it, like conduits. Most of it are siphoning it off and into Bushel's horn.
She glared at Sawdust. I thought you said the writing wasn't important!
Sawdust's composed look faltered at Steve's anger.
I said I didn't think it was! It could be part of whatever old magic was used here when the shrine was first made. I don't know for certain. Regardless, our only hope is the ritual. Bushel should be safe once it's completed.
Trixie frowned, wishing she knew more about Bushel's condition. There was nothing to get to, however, but push forward. The cavern soon narrowed past the nest, turning from a fairly wide open area into a constricted tunnel winding down into an angle into the earth. After a moment of stumbling over the uneven floor, Trixie looked down and realized with a start that some pony had fastened, probably via magic, a crude set of stairs into the stone. The cavern was gradually turned into a spiral staircase of stone, the mind-bending, spiraling arcane writing flowing along the walls and ceiling in thicker and denser qualities the deeper they went.
At what point in time did Tarnus ever think making this place her home was a good idea?
Asked Trixie, not expecting an answer, but Sawdust offered one up anyway.
There was nothing too unusual about this place at first, said Sawdust. No whispers, no darkness, just a simple cave with some odd writing on it. I think that by the time she would have realized something was amiss, it was already too late. This happened gradually, Miss Trixie, not all at once.
She was casting nervous looks all around him, as if he expected writing on the walls to perhaps spring to life and attack, or if the shadows beyond their horn lights started spotting nightmarish things in her path.
I don't understand it. If there is some kind of spirit in the shrine, why isn't it trying harder to stop us? It's just letting us walk right into its heart without so much as a little wind and a few voices in our heads as resistance.
Two possibilities as I see it,
said Trixie, as he saw the stairs come to a stop ahead at the worked archway of stone, where a natural cavern stopped completely. It took on more the appearance of the interior of a fastened room, with smooth stone and not a hint of natural rock formation in sight.
One,
The spirit is blowing so much of its energy in the storm above that it doesn't have anything left to resist us with, besides what we've already seen.
So he stepped into the gloom of the room, one hoof clopping onto the stone, creating an echo that joined her voice.
Or two! It's been saving its strength until we got here, so it can hit us with everything it has.
Light from a horn cast the room in a pale blue pool that sent sows skittering away like cockroaches. One by one, the others entered right behind her, adding their light to hers. Trixie noted the chamber they entered was perfectly circular in shape, large enough that dozens of ponies could have gathered in it. At the center of the chamber was a cluster of stone pillars, arranged in a perfect circle, just like the chamber itself. The six pillars each bore carved holes up and down their length, where various objects were placed. Daggers curved like waves, anvil skulls bedecked with fiery runes, like the writing in the cave above. The stone bore fezzes shaped in the likeness of the equine form, wax-coated jars of unidentifiable liquids. And those were just the times Trixie could easily discern what they were.
Well, said Trixie, I can see why you kept calling this place a shrine, Sawdust.
It does seem to be the only word to suit, he replied, pulling out his journal. Let's begin. The first thing we need to do is...
You're wasting your time.
The voice came from across the room, a female voice that Trixie instantly recognized, but hadn't all expected to hear. Stepping around from the pillars, all but sauntering with a confident swagger that Trixie knew too well, because there was a point in time she practiced that walk in a mirror on a daily basis, was a mare, a pale blue unicorn mare, with a silver mane and a distinctive hat and cape.
That spell won't possibly work with a pony like her being a part of your efforts,
said Trixie, or rather, the mare who looked identical to Trixie. Trixie, the actual Trixie took a step back, mind-boggling for a moment as she managed to compose herself.
You're not real. You're just some figment or illusion conjured by the shrine.
The fake Trixie rolled her eyes.
Figured that all on your own, did you? Didn't strain any blood vessels in that tiny, atrophied brain coming up with that unimaginative conclusion.
Trixie narrowed her eyes.
Not just an illusion. An irritating one. Great!
What are you exactly? Sawdust asked, as he slowly walked to the right, circling the false Trixie. The figment, not that Trixie was looking at it closely, was easy to tell apart from her. His eyes lacked color. They were just straight black, no definition. The realization made her coat crawl. The shadows of the room seemed to creep in on their own pools of light, cast by their horns, and the air became coilingly humid, yet incredibly cold. Trixie could hear the sharp, clawing whispers again, quiet, as if they were trying to allow the illusion to speak. But so many voices now, trying to scratch their way into her head.
I was part of a whole once that had a name, a feared name that all ponies bow to,
said now a male voice, as a stallion who bore an identical appearance to Sawdust appeared in Sawdust's path, with the same dead black eyes as the place of Sawdust's natural colors.
That name no longer matters. The princess has defeated the whole, and the whole in its defeat broke off parts of itself, scattered them across the land, so that if the whole ever returned, it would gather those pieces of itself that it left behind, and regain its power. That is what I am, a left-behind piece of a whole, a forgotten whisper.
Sawdust drew the start of his counterpart, looking the illusion over, and after a second waving a hoof at the other at Sawdust, the illusionary Sawdust wove apart like a bank of fog, but reformed just as quickly.
These whispers, I suppose, are not solid, Sawdust said, trying and failing not to look somewhat disturbed.
Illusions, as Miss Trixie says. I think it's using the method is because it cannot break into our minds completely with the seals in its place.
The Whisperer Sawdust laughed, cold, mocking.
Or perhaps I'm already in your minds, it said as it looked at Trixie. He's going to betray you, you know. His ambitions don't know any limits. And you really think he's just going to let you turn him in to the authorities?
Pitsgrass tied forward, face drawn in tight anger.
My brother isn't going to turn on us, not with his niece Laugh's sake.
Oh, do you actually believe that?
Asked another voice, and a whisper of Pitsgrass formed from the shadows on the mare's left, dancing to run a smoky hoof over Bustle's form before Pitsgrass turned to snarl at the whisper, backing away.
Get your hooves off of my daughter!
The whisper of Pitsgrass smiled, far too wide for a natural pony's mouth, reaching from ear to ear.
Oh, I like that. Nothing like a mother's wrath. The flavor of that anger is just so rich. Seriously, though, do you believe your brother isn't planning something?
I'll trust him, Pitsgrass said firmly. I've always trusted him. He's not a bad pony. The whisper laughed.
Oh, and you just sound so convinced of that. Is that why he asked you to lie to your husband? To connive and manipulate your beloved chief into doing what Sawdust wants?
Pitsgrass saw falter, and Trixie was quick to jump in.
Just tune them out, every pony! This is just a last-ditch effort to try and stop us, and it's a pathetic and transparent attempt at that!
The whisper of Trixie scoffed and came right up to Trixie, smiling sickly sweet.
You know all about pathetic attempts, wouldn't you, great and powerful Trixie? How many mistakes and bubbling screw-ups have mocked your life so far, hmm? The laughing stock of the night court, a joke of a representative, and a lousy friend. Barely able to hold on to the few ponies who could stomach your so-called friendship.
Trixie scoffed, then frowned as he realized how closely she mirrored a whisper.
Really? Is this the best ammo you have to use against me? My ego is not that fragile.
Oh, really?
Trixie said, flicking a smoky trail at Trixie's nose, causing Trixie to shiver at the coldness of the whisper's touch. Incidental they were, but their cold touch was shiver-inducing.
I suppose you know better than any pony how strong your ego is. So strong it requires you to lie to an innocent feeling to stroke it!
That got to Trixie to wince, but she regrouped quickly.
I didn't lie to her, I...
But her whisper vanished, not giving Trixie a chance to finish her sentence. Reappeared by Picturesque. The whisper struck a mockingly heroic pose while looking down at the unconscious Bustle.
Do not fear, my little pony. I, the hero of Oaton, shall save your family and friends without fail, for I am the right hoof of justice, whose magic knows no equal in all the realm. Trixie does not speak like that!
The whisper's tone took on a tiny squeak, mock version of Bustle's.
Oh, great and powerful Trixie, you're so awesome. Certainly you never ever exaggerate who or what you are just to make yourself look better in my eyes. I want to grow up to be just like you, so I can lie to ponies about who I am too.
Trixie felt fury flare up inside her, and she advanced with bare teeth.
I am not rising to this bait. It didn't happen that way. Okay, it didn't happen exactly that way. It doesn't matter. I've already fessed up to Oaton about everything. You're not driving my dad to me with this farce!
Oh, fessed up to Oaton? But not to this poor little filly,
said the whisper with a predatory smile.
What will she think of you, I wonder, when she learns of your lies? Will she be forgiving? Devastated? Will she cry that her idol is nothing more than a fake straw hero?
Trixie clenched her teeth together so tight, she tasted a slight tang of blood. She knew Whisper was digging at her weakest points. All of their weak points. Knowing that didn't make it any easier to take. Trixie took a deep breath and met her Whisper's inky black eyes.
Whatever she may think, I'll come clean to her on it all and accept the consequences. Thing is, straw hero or not, I'm more than enough to deal with a two-bit whisper like you. Compared to Corona, you're nothing special.
The whisper of Trixie sniffed at that, walking through Pisserus like a phantom. Piscaress yelped at the cold and rapidly away from to whisper of Trixie, but that only put her closer to her own whisper. The whisper of Piscaress seemed to turn into a haze and appeared next to Seif, raising a hoof towards his face, but he growled and banged at the hoof. The hoof merely wafted into smoke, reforming a moment later, much to the whisper's amusement.
"I'm awfully quiet, aren't we, Seath? Here you are, surrounded by ponies that have done nothing but lie to you, and do you think you can place any faith in them? In a supposed friend who conspired to destroy your home? In a wife that lied to your face? In an overblown braggart who came here only to bask in unearned praise?"
Sheath's on the other side, his own whisper finally appeared, flanking him with the whisper of Pescaresque, leaning in and saying in a tone hard as the stone chamber was carved from,
"They can't save your home. You can't trust any of them. Bear to work alone, for Oaton stand alone, like it always has."
Sheath's eyes were closed, his entire body stuck as he listened to his whisper's words. Trixie looked down worriedly.
"Sheath, don't listen to this. It's just trying to get us to turn on each other."
"Oh, I don't have to do much in that regard."
Chuckled the whisper of sawdust in Trixie's ear as he appeared next to her.
"Mistrust, anger, fear, pain, desperation, greed. I didn't put any of those feelings inside ponies. They're simply already a part of you. Ponies never change. Bubbly, happy, sunshine on the surface. But underneath that, you're all little pressure cookers of wretchedness, just waiting for an excuse to boil over."
Trixie stared hard daggers at the whispers, even though she knew her anger could only be feeding that thing. She looked to Sheath, who still held Sawdust's journal, but remained quiet, eyes still closed.
"Sheath, we have to start the ritual," she said,
trying to ignore the derisive language of her own whisper.
"The longer we talk to these things, the more power we give them." "Can you really listen to the words of an incompetent fraud?"
asked the whisper of Trixie, spinning her own phantom of Trixie's head at her hoof.
"A stage magician who so far has only given your town empty promises. What has she really done since coming to Oaton? Spout worthless hot air and my wife,"
she said, slowly opening his eyes to stare at the whisper. The whisper cocked his head.
"What?"
"Trixie Lulamoon returned my wife to me. Turned cold dead stone into a living pony once again."
She strode past the whispers, trying right out to Trixie.
"I don't trust Sawdust. I still love my wife, but she's got a lot of work to do to earn my trust again as well. But you, Trixie Lulamoon, are no fraud, and I've already decided to place my hopes for Oaton's future on you."
Trixie stared at him for a second, surprised at the onus tone in his voice, denied with enthusiasm.
"Thank you, Sheath."
Sawdust looked at the two with a small smile, then turned to his whisper.
"You're not nearly as good as this as you seem to think you are,"
the lover guild told the leader whisper as he joined in Trixie and Sheath near the pedestals of the shrine. The whispers all scowled as one, turning and hazy and vanishing, all save for the whisper of Trixie. Was followed Piscaresque as the mayor trotted up to the group with Bushel.
What should I do with Bushel?" asked Piscaresque. "Does he have to be anywhere specific?"
"She'll need to be inside the ritual circle," said Sawdust. "Don't let her go for a single moment, sister."
"A waste of time," said the whisperer Dresky. "The filly is sick, dying, and her foolish and incompetent hero can't do a single thing to fix her. In fact,"
the whisper appeared in Trixie's face again, disdainful eyes, an unsettling mirror of Trixie's own.
"Bushel only got this way because she had to save you, didn't she?"
Trixie could hear her blood pounding in her ears, her anger rising, mind shield or not. She shoved it aside as best she could, ignoring the whisper. She did not want to give this thing the satisfaction of a reaction. Even so, her eyes slid toward where Picturesque had laid down between her, Sheath and Sawdust. The filly was cradled in the mother's hooves. Trixie's cape was still wrapped around her. Trixie felt a sharp stab of guilt, remembering how happy and full of energy Bussel had been when Trixie first met her. It was painful to see the filly like this, knowing it was her fault. The whisper glowered, to smile cruelly.
Do you see yet? At least with all your previous screw-ups, a foal didn't suffer for them. Now, none of your past mistakes have the quite the same repercussions this one does. Before, the stakes were just your papier-mâché ego. Now, it's the future of dozens of ponies who could lose their homes and their lives if you fail, including one innocent filly who thinks you're far greater than you know you actually are. Then I won't fail, said Trixie past clenched teeth. You won't fail? Your track record says otherwise. What track record? I've been doing pretty well for myself since I came to Ponyville, Trixie said back while trying to keep her emotions calm. Maybe you don't know, having been literally living under a rock, but my friends and I saved all of Equestria. That's no boast or lie, just fact.
The whisper snored, rolling his eyes.
Fact. Ha! The fact is that you failed to actually banish Corona. And because of your weakness, the tired sun still threatens the freedom of every mare, stallion, and foal in the land. Oh yes, such a great success!
The whisper shoved an accusatory hoof on Trixie's nose.
Even in winning, you still managed to screw up! You're grasping at straws. My friends and I, we beat Corona, earned the right to wield the elements of harmony. You're not poking at holes in my resolve this easy. I'm stronger than that,
Trixie said, taking hold of her emotions, pushing down the doubts that Whisper's words conjured, not to mention the anger. Trixie was now quite glad Raindrops had sent for the second half of the ritual, as Trixie didn't want to subject her friend to this entity's tactics. Trixie, remember when you told me not to listen to this thing? Said Sheath. Might want to take your own advice.
I know, said Trixie. But she's really annoying!
Sawdust coughed politely. It has a good template to work off for that purpose. Trixie saw him look.
Not helping!
Sheath had set the journal down between them, pages open to the ritual. Trixie, despite the tremble in her legs that was one part rage and one part fear, focused her attention on the writings. Despite her lack of ability with figuring spells out via written format, the ritual was actually quite simple enough in design that she could get the gist of it by looking. The three unicorns involved instantly formed a bulwark of a barrier, one that formed what Trixie could tell was designed to pull in negative energies that contained them inside the confines of the barrier. Ritual magic was uncommon in the modern age, if mainly because most rituals took a long number of unicorns to work and took a long amount of time to cast. The kind of thing just stopped being practical or useful in Equestria's modern age. Trixie realized it was strange that this ritual only required three unicorns, where a circle of 7 or 13 was far more common. I'll start. The two of you follow my lead, says Sawdust, as his horn glowed with greater intensity. At the time, Sheath and Trixie both began to pour magic into their own horns. Magical sight was not needed to follow Sawdust's lead. The rituals created patterns of light to show where Trixie and Sheath needed to direct their own magic. Trixie concentrated on pushing the tendrils of her magic into the patterns she saw, watching as her blue magic interlaced slowly with Sheath's yellow and Sawdust's white. The magical energy traced along the ground and in the air, forming a circle on the ground consisting of 2 layers of arcane sigils. The outer layer was a magic funnel, sucking in negative energy. The inner layer was the barrier that would keep that energy trapped at one point. The barrier formed in the air was above the center of the arcane circle in the shape of an inverted pyramid. The walls were shifting in colors in between the three unicorns' magic. Trixie hadn't been able to tell much about the ritual when it was on paper, but now, seeing in action, she was able to see how this part of the spell was designed to be maintained, but left hanging threads of magical energy that didn't seem to serve a purpose. That must be where the second half of the ritual was meant to lock into the first half. The whisper of Trixie was snarling as the unicorns cast the ritual, snarling her face right against Trixie, though she lacks substance to touch the real Trixie.
Ignore me if you will, but you know you'll fail. You don't have enough magic to hold the ritual for this long.
The wisps of a shadow were being pulled of the whisper, like smoke being sucked away by a current of wind, trailing into a space just above the glowing ritual circle. It was distorting the whisper's voice as the image started to get pulled into that space, joining a glowing cloud of rolling dark gray smoke that was forming.
You won't hold on to them. Your friends! You're scared of that, Trixie Lulamoon!
The whisper was mostly a formless gray smoke now, just barely a Trixie shape.
You don't believe in harmony. That's the real reason you didn't send for the rest of your friends in the elements. You don't believe they worked for you! Not for you, who always loses her friends!
The whisper's voice faded away, as the hazy smoke that made up its form was pulled into the now swirling cloud that was gathered above the ritual circle. Trixie was sweating cold, trickles of it running down her neck. Even just a few minutes into the ritual, her horn was sending spikes of pain into her protest. She really had used up too much magic fighting Tarnished earlier. Did she really have enough to hold this ritual for hours?
Stay focused!
Said Thief, his face a stone mask of concentration, his horn blazing yellow.
Whatever it meant by those words, don't get distracted by them! I'm not!
Trixie said, wincing.
I'm the picture of focus! Stupid shrine entity thing was talking about its flank anyway! I don't doubt the elements of harmony! There just wasn't any guarantee they work here!
You had good enough reasons to not send for them, said Sawdust. And Trixie felt a little better, seeing as he was sweating butt under the strain too. Not much, but a little. Just good to know she wasn't the only unicorn having difficulty with this.
It looks like this being is trying to focus its insidious efforts on you in particular. I think it's afraid of you. Perhaps it senses you're the linchpin of our efforts. If it breaks you, we won't be far behind.
It isn't talking much now,
Trixie observed with some satisfaction.
The ritual is pulling the entity and its errancies into this one spot, and trapping it inside the barrier we're forming. I doubt it can form any more whispers, says Sawdust, but gave them all a cautious look. It may still be able to try influencing us. However, be wary. I doubt it's not resisting us.
And we have hours to wait, holding this ritual until Raindrops returns,
Trixie thought, a sinking feeling in her gut. But as much as she felt strain on her horn, she just needed one look at Bushel to know every bit of pain she was going through was worth it, if they could save her.
Raindrops, hurry!
Tarnished was kept looking away every time Cheerilee noticed her staring. Fear lanced through Tarnished, her thoughts a mirrored jumble that she was barely keeping together. Right now, they were dominated by,
please don't ask, please don't ask, please don't ask, please don't ask, please don't ask. Tarn, were you looking at my flank?
Dread! She asked!
Unknown,
she said far too quickly. Cheerilee slowed slightly, driving to back where she was now alongside Tarnished. They had been galloping towards a tourney and rapidly flooding banks of the river, towards where Tarnished knew a local colony of beavers lived. They were nearly there, and for most of it, Tarnished had to avoid conversation with Cheerilee as much as possible, too afraid and too confused to know what to say, not after what she had done. But she had, against her own better judgment, snuck numerous glances at Cheerilee. It was just, Tarnished didn't know what to feel. Cheerilee was right there in front of her, and despite all the horrible things Tarnished had said and did, Cheerilee was just acting like everything was going to be okay. And Tarnished felt like she might actually believe that. It was strange. She just kept wanting to look at Cheerilee, and sort of through everything, but there wasn't there time. And the idea of actually having a conversation terrified her. It was sort of coincidental that Cheerilee had caught Tarnished looking, just as Tarnished was taking note of Cheerilee's cutie mark.
Oh, it's just,
Tarnished said after an awkward silence.
I was thinking about the cutie mark. I never could see how it would relate to your decision to become a teacher. I always assumed it represented us, the gang, and how you kept us together, happy.
Cheerilee chuckled. On Luna's pure mood, how Tarnished missed that sound.
It's a little abstract, isn't it? The flowers represent ponies, yes, you guys in the gang, but also my students. Their smiles, their laughter, as they grow and learn.
My kitty mark is my love for helping any pony grow. I just realized that foals need that kind of guidance the most,
Cheerilee said, the warmth in her voice seeming to push back the very cold of the rain that soaked their coats. The storm had actually ended a mile back, sent it completely over the dam in Oaton. The tires could see it as a black solid disk of cloud in the sky. It was still at other odds with the clear, star-filled sky outside the storm.
It's a good kitty mark,
Tara said, ears lowering against the side of her head. She blinked, trying to keep herself from crying. Hadn't she done that enough already? Yet, it was beyond hard to keep any kind of rein over her emotions. She was still caught between wanting to throw herself at Cheerilee and hug a friend just to make sure Cheerilee was real, and that this wasn't some fever dream, and equally wanting to still strangle the mare to satisfy the anger, still clawing at the edges of her mind and heart.
Oh, Cheerilee, she said at length, how could you just act so normal, like nothing happened? I tried to hurt you, kill you even! Your friends, I would have killed them too, even my own brother! I still don't know if I can even trust myself to not just lose it against all hell.
Stop it, Tarn. Don't tear yourself up, okay? Said Cheerilee, voice firm, but also filled with concern and a warmth that Tarnus had just as much comfort to turmoil in her.
I won't hear any more of you hurting yourself. Not one more word. When this is over, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take you for a night in the town like you never imagined. They're going to hear us celebrating it all the way to Kavala. We've got years of catching up to do, and I don't plan on letting you sit out on a moment of it.
Tarnus just stared at Cheerilee. For a moment, too stunned to even think straight. Then, slowly, she smiled, laughing like she hadn't had in Luna, not in years. But she couldn't help but shake her head, eventually.
Oh, Cheerilee, out of this, the authorities, the things I've done, I don't think I'll be able to bus go anywhere. Might have to settle for visiting me at whatever institute I end up in.
She tried to keep her tone light, Luna's tears, it was hard, to make it sound like a little joke. She found Cheerilee staring at her with a look of utter seriousness that again stunned Tarnus.
Nonsense. You weren't in your right mind. There are...
Cheerilee hesitated.
There are excruciating circumstances. The princess will understand.
The school teacher didn't smile ruefully.
And if she doesn't, well, I'll just have to make her understand. With my hoof.
I don't think your students would appreciate their teacher getting banished to the sun for decking the princess of the night.
Tarnus said, unable to keep from smiling a bit at the thought of the magenta mare punting Equestria's monarch.
Republic does surprise the immortal Alicorn more than actually harm her.
It'll be okay.
Cheerilee was silent at that, face a mask of thought, and Tarnus could imagine her friend was mentally reviewing her knowledge of Equestrian law to look for loopholes to get Tarnus out of jail. Tarnus finally let out a small smile on her face, realizing just how much her friend was trying to do what Cheerilee always did. Brighten the moon, and hence the lives of her friends.
I can accept whatever happens, Tara said, because I know, when I get out, however many years it is, you'll still be there waiting for me. You'll still be friends.
Cheerilee made a small sniffing sound, clicking away from Tarnist, so she didn't know why. The rain hid the tears pretty well already. They continued on in silence for a few minutes after that, Tarnist feeling the turmoil inside her calming. Perhaps due to getting some distance from the storm, or simply because Cheerilee's presence. Up ahead, a small tributary from the forest entered the river, just as it started to curve to the northeast, around the border of the trees. The tributary was marked by the thicket of logs and branches of a natural beaver dam, one of several Tarnus knew existed along this tributary.
I hope they're home,
Tarnus said, approaching the logs, casting a wary look at the banks of the larger river.
The flooding might have scared them off.
She cleared her throat, then made a series of rough chattering noises that most ponies would strain their voices trying to duplicate. But to Tarnus, just came naturally. It wasn't necessarily to actually use the beaver's own sounds. The animals more or less understood her, no matter if she spoke Equestrian. But if they were scared of the storm, she wanted to ease them out of hiding with familiar sounds. Her communication spell wouldn't work unless she had hard line of sight to cast it. Though, once cast, the line of sight could be broken, and the spell remained functioning, but in this case, it wouldn't be needed. The beavers, about a dozen of them, gradually poked their heads out of various hiding spots.
The largest is among them, tromping up to Tarnus, and waving its little paws in the air, as it made a bunch of chattering noises at her. Animals didn't really speak with words all that much, but implied meaning through a combination of smell, body language, and a flight of natural noises. The beaver was asking her what was going on, and why she was here. The family of beavers knew her, of course. She had been this way on walks plenty of times. The beavers more or less trusted her, though they were more surly bunts than any of the other animals in this area. Tyrus knelt down, taking a calming breath to steady herself. Animals could sense emotion, as she didn't want the beavers upset by her own troubled state. She made a number of chattering noises back at the beaver, waving her hoof in her own set of gestures, to which the beaver responded with even more exaggerated wave of its arms and shake of its head. Cheerilee, standing back a few paces to give Tarnus space, said,
"He looks kind of angry."
Tarnus frowned. "See, actually. She doesn't want to risk her alone to help with the dam. River is too dangerous to swim, she says. I can't really argue that point. It will be dangerous." Cheerilee looked downriver, worried heads on her face, toward the storm, where Tarnus could imagine the ponies of Oaton, Lumbergill, and her own brother, and his house guard, would be struggling to keep the beleaguered dam from shattering and drowning them all. Tarnus took a steady breath, and spoke again with the beaver. She didn't know if it would rather be possible to pass things with her brother, but as much as she felt strange for him, she didn't want Shiny to die. She pleaded with the beavers, and while the leader looked about ready to refuse her again, it was stopped by several others that had come out of hiding in the bushes. Tarnus recognized ones she helped treat for illness or injuries many times over the long months she lived there. It became clear very soon that, despite the leader's honest worries for their safety, most of the beavers remembered Tarnus fondly, and were willing to help her for this, and only time she ever asked them for help. Tarnus felt relief flood through her, and as she rose, she felt a hoof pat on her back, and looked over at Cheerilee's smiling face.
"From that sigh of relief, I guess they're going to help?"
Tarnus nodded.
"Yes. I wish I didn't have to ask them to do this for me, though. It's not why I made friends with them, just to ask for things in return."
"Of course not," said Cheerilee. "But there's nothing wrong with asking for help when it's needed. In times of trouble, friends will be there."
She trailed off, eyes downcast. Tarnus looked at Cheerilee's crestfallen face. Couldn't imagine how she could ever doubted this mare. How she ever could have allowed herself to become so twisted up inside with anger at Cheerilee.
"Oh, I am such an idiot. I've never known a pony who cared more about his friends. And I somehow thought she abandoned me. She never once stopped caring. I was the one who abandoned her by hiding myself away and spending years just blaming her."
Coming back a sob, Tarnus wrapped hose around Cheerilee, pulling her close.
"You were there, Cheerilee. I was just too blind to see you never really left. I just can't believe I forgot."
"Huh?
Your kitty mark. It's a wreath of ivy,"
Cheerilee said, laughing and crying at the same time.
"I remember when you got it, when we went to the Griffin Kingdoms."
Tarnus blinked, looking back at her flank, where a circle of interwoven grain of ivy strands it depicted.
"When I saw the jewel Rainbow Shine got herself stuck in, that's the day when I realized I never wanted to let anything happen to my friends, my real family, and keep us all together. Like ivy, an age-old symbol of friendship and strong bonds,"
Cheerilee said, wiping her face and looking toward the south, toward Oaton. The storm was still there, but to Cheerilee's eyes, it seemed to be contracting, pulling back at the edges and concentrating at a focal point over the forest. As Cheerilee squinted her eyes, she could imagine see a funnel of black clouds swirling downward into the tree line.
"They must be doing that ritual as we speak. Time to do our part too. Let's get back to the dam!"
Count Shiny was out of his element. He was a noble of the Night Court and had been raised to lead. But really, most of his training had involved leader of somewhat. Drenched for detached variety. Stabbing hesitation and political maneuvering. Knowing what provisions might help his providence. And how to help negotiate with other nobles over tea. There had been little training to prevent him from the confusion, chaos, and sudden decision-making of directing somewhere around 150 ponies and a desperate bid to keep a floating dam from breaking apart in front of them. While a massive magical storm raced above, naturally increasing the aggressive tendencies of any pony underneath it. He'd been spending most of his time rushing from one end of the dam to the other, trying to keep ponies from three different groups from bickering and fighting, keeping them focused on the task at hoof. Amazingly, the threat of imminent destruction to hearth and home, not to mention their lives, gave him quite a bit of ammunition to use in the disputing arguments.
Lock a key! You and Miss Freshop get your teams over to the left side and help those digging there get Luke's logs in place, he said, rain blinding him momentarily as he wiped his face, getting his tangled mane out of his eyes.
The young house guard and almost as young lumber guild mare nodded to him, running off with their small team of ponies. Shiny was standing atop the dam itself, honestly the only place he could get best look at everything, despite the danger of slossy water almost sweeping him off the top. Other ponies worked to bring freshly cut planks of wood up to reinforce the breaking struts on top of the dam, while most of the rest were digging a wall of dirt and supporting logs around the areas where the wall of ice failed to reach. The ice wall itself was being sustained by truly Alicornian efforts of cut and dry and the remaining unicorn mazes of the copper and coin house guard. The spell-linking wands would be draining them at a ludicrous rate, pushing their arcane endurance to the limits. Yet the unicorns doggedly held on, maintaining their large shelf of thick ice that was at this point the only reason the battered dam had remained intact, and why the banks of the river still haven't flooded them yet. Shiny's heart groaned every time he saw Cut and Dry down there. Her own white line flickered into the darkness. How much longer could she last? If the owner channeled, it'd be his fault for ordering her to do this, despite the dangers.
I could just order my ponies out of here. They'd be safe. I owe Oaton and the lumber guild nothing. If the wanna sweeps them on her way, no witnesses to tell what happened.
Shiny nearly vomited his stomach as he turned at his own thoughts.
Those couldn't be his own thoughts, could they? It had to be the storm's negative energies affecting him, right?
He shook his head fiercely and pushed the horrible thoughts away. He did owe Oaton. It was a village on his family's land. These ponies were his responsibility. He was a noble of the Night Court, and these were his little ponies to care for. To have forgotten that, even for his sister's sake, it filled him with revulsion. As much as he didn't want to admit it, Trixie Lulamoon, a bubbly representative and nothing more, had shown more nobility than he did. If he survived this, he either thanked the mayor or choked her. He wasn't sure which yet.
Lock a key! Mr. Bronzebell! We've got the leak right up there!
He said, pointing a hoof at one of the nearby sections of the dam, at the top, which had burst and was letting out a stream of water over the top of the ice wall.
I'll hold it, but we need more planks up here to seal it!
There were no other ponies nearby, so Shiny himself had to rush over and shove his hooves onto the camp, trying to stem the flow of water while Lock a Key, so similar in appearance to his elder sister Cut and Dry, rushed up alongside an older stallion from Oaton, a bronze-coated fellow with a blonde mane and bell for a cutie mark. They carried wood planks and tools between them.
My lord, we can get back! We can handle this!
Said Lock and Key.
Do not concern yourself with me, he said to the young house guard.
Do hurry and hold forward those planks if you will!
You nobles always dang stubborn!
Asked Bronzebell, as he knelt down over to the side of the dam with Lock and Key, started giving planks to Shining.
Though, never figured I'd see one of you taps getting his own hooves dirty in the thick of things.
Count Shining didn't respond, just concentrating on getting the planks in place for Lock and Key, and Bronzebell to hammer them into place over the sprung leak. After a harrowing minute that felt closer to an hour, the leak was sealed, and Count Shining rose, wiping his brow of sweat and rain both.
Well, this is...
Count Shining began to say, when a massive server of water over the lip of the dam swept the walkway he was on, and he felt his hooves fly out under him. He felt his head smack into something solid, probably the very walkway he was on, and lights flooded his vision. Unable to respond, he felt his body twist in momentary free fall before enveloping by on all sides by freezing, wet blackness. He instinctively opened his mouth to scream, but that just flooded waters into his lungs. Sputtering, legs flailing, he just panicked in inky darkness. Thoughts of Cheerilee and Tarnas both flooded his mind. He struggled to try and swim, despite having no idea which way was up, and the horrible, burning pain of water in his lungs as he tried to keep from breathing in any more. He felt things start to fade, his limbs going numb. Then, warm hose were on his body, tugging, another set around his neck. In seconds, he felt his head break the surface, sputtered and coughed, still trying to breathe.
How dare they name it? Quit kicking!
said a high, pale female voice. My lord, do like the lady says and stop flailing before you hit something, and I prefer you didn't, said a voice that sounded suspiciously like Boothiel's.
Despite every instinct he had to the contrary, Shining forced himself to relax as he was dragged through the surging, black water. He could barely make out the sight of a mare that what might have been a white coat, but it was hard to tell under the circumstances. On the other side of him was Boothiel, waving with one hoof at him.
A little help here! Hold on! Said a voice from the dam. Potato Jack, get the rope! Has the rope!
Said another voice. Shiny heard something splash in the water a few meters to his right.
Potato, throw the rope
to them!
Run! Can't see we're spinning this rain!
Stop playing around, you damn horses!
Screamed the white bay, her voice, if anything, getting higher in pitch.
Laugh at damn situation here! Just aiming the sound of my voice!
Yeah, you're extremely irate, shrill voice.
Is that any reason why your parents named you Papper?
Potato, I will soak that rope straight where Luna's light don't shine if you don't get us out of this water right back in hell!
Boothiel made a sound. Shiny couldn't fathom why the stallion was looking over at the white-coated mare with such calm consideration, given that they were struggling to stay afloat in the raging water reservoir. Soon, there was a rope tossed back out, and this time, the white mare, Piper, catching in her teeth. Within minutes, they were hauled onto the dam by a pair of Oaton stallions, who, from the looks of their smaller, similar, darker coats, may well have been brothers. Causing out water from his burning lungs, Shiny just laid there, clinging onto the edge of the dam fiercely. While above him, Boothiel wrung his mane and tail out and grinned at the white mare, who in turn was shaking her sopping black mane.
Piper, right?
Asked Boothiel, with a lick of his lips and an undisguised look to the Oaton mare's flanks.
You free next Tuesday?
The mare gave him a flat look, then snorted and hauled Count Shiny to his hooves, looking to noble over.
You around there, you normal sleep?
Shiny nodded briefly, still trying to cough out water in his lungs.
Thank you.
Ain't nothing. You're doing a right fine job tossing bustles about. Figure it'd be a shame to watch you drown. After all, not court might replace you with something worse.
She glanced over him, and Shiny felt a stab in his heart and his cheeks as she checked over his flanks.
Certainly worse looking, anyway. Come on, you noble ship, hoity-toity countesses. Let's get back to saving our town.
Count Shining blinked and followed the mare, leaving behind a dumbfounded Boothiel. It was a quiet night at the royal palace of Canterlot. Clear skies allowed the brilliance of Luna's night to shine down the two night guard that flanked the first set of gates leading to the palace grounds. One, an older veteran, the other, a fresh recruit just out of training. The pair of guards that were polar opposites in behavior. The experienced night guard was alert, but calm, casually enjoying the fresh night breeze and grandeur of that diamond dust outstretching in the skies. The recruit wasn't paying the night sky any mind, and instead was tensely looking all around, hyper alert for danger to the point of distraction.
Recruit, if you stay that tight around, you're going to go gray in your bed before I do, said the friend.
Yes, sir, help, sir,
said the recruit. And promptly resumed skittishly glaring at every shadow in sight. Starhelm sighed. The kid would just have to learn on his own then. Well, there was some reason to be more wary. With the possible threat of the tyrant sun looming over all of Equestria, Starhelm had discovered it did little good to be overzealous in one's duty. Tended to give just one a sour stomach, an aching head, and premature wrinkles. Besides, what could possibly happen on such a peaceful night? Something slammed into the cobbled street before the palace gates, with enough force to send stone flying into the air. Starhelm shielded his eyes with one wing, while the recruit yelled in surprise.
Stars above!
He grunted, pulling aside his wing and peering at what landed before him. A Pegasus mare, her jasmine coat slick with sweat, a teal mane ragged and plastered her face, was standing in the street, her hooves cracking the cobblestones from the impact of her sudden, rough landing. She was breathing hard, as he had just flown a marathon, and Starhelm blinked in surprise as he saw not only she had a pair of natural wings, but a glowing, incandescent pair of wings behind her natural ones he can only imagine had been conjured by magic.
Made it!
The mare said, taking a shaking step forward.
The recruit lowered his spear.
Hold! Declare yourself and your intent!
Mira raised her head, still sucking in and out lungfuls of air. Her eyes held an intensity as he looked right at the recruit, and the night guard took a hesitant step back from the force of that gaze.
Princess Luna!
Demare blinked and shook her head and appeared to collect herself.
Yeah, need to see Princess Luna! It's an emergency!
Ha! Huh. As if Lee doesn't allow anybody to see the princess! Or else you're an assassin sent by the tyrant's son!
The Groot said, pointing his spear at the mare's face. The mare ignored the spear, instead blowing out a snort that all but steamed from her clear aggravation.
I don't have time for this! Pony slander at stake! You have to let me see the princess!
Myus! Starhelm stepped forward, passed the recruit's spear, and gave the mare a calm look.
If there's an emergency of some sort, you must at least give us some idea what it is and who you are. Don't need the whole story, just the basics. Please, due process. It'll make things faster in the long run.
You can see the Henson flowing through every inch of this Pegasus mare, but he didn't think she was lying. Some Harold couldn't quite put his mouth on it, but she had this earnest look to her. Perhaps it was those eyes. She had honest eyes. He didn't think it was a trick by some minion of Corona.
My name is Raindrops. I'm a weather pony from Ponyville. Some of my friends and I were dealing with a problem in the village called Oaton, and it's gotten completely out of hoof. There's an evil spirit there, causing a storm that's going to flood a dam and destroy the town. There's a spell to stop it, but part of it is in the university here in Canterlot. I need to find that spell, but I also need to tell the princess what's happening. She can help me find the spell and get me back to Oaton fast. Oh, and my friends and I are bearers of the element of Saharmony, so I'd really appreciate it if you skip the interrogation and take me to the fucking princess!
How dare you speak of the princess with such vulgar terms!
Said the recruit, but somehow kept a calmer state, taking in Raindrop's words. Looking at her again, he realized she did match the description of one of the element bearers. All of the Night Guard had been given descriptions of the mares who were now key to the nation's defense, as he did bear the proper coloring and name. That didn't necessarily prove anything, not in a realm where magic could disguise a pony's appearance easily. And there were creatures who could take on the looks of another as naturally as others put on a set of clothes. But again, those honest, intense eyes spoke the truth.
Farewell, Miss Raindrops. I'm inclined to believe you, he said. However, the princess is not available.
Not available? Why?
Ahem, if you let me finish. The princess is not in Canterlot at this time. She's currently taking care of a diplomatic issue up north with the Griffins. We can get a message to her fast enough with magic, but it may take her hours or more to return, assuming she just dropped what she was going to do.
Raindrop's jaw worked silently for a second, veins popping out along her brow as her eyes widened, her face bleeding over red. Starhel raised an eyebrow as the mare trembled for a second, then widened his eyes as he all but exploded in rage, rearing up on her hind legs.
Burn it all to the core of the sun!
She slammed her host to the ground, cracking another poor, hopeless cobblestone in half.
I have to get that spell back to Oaton! Now! They're all counting on me!
Miss Raindrops, please calm yourself!
How am I supposed to remain calm?
Just breathe, ma'am. Even if the princess were here, it'd take time to process you meeting her with her. We couldn't just see you through to her. There are rules to follow. And seeing a questionless ruler such as Norris, well, there are no provisions for the bearers of elements of harmony to avoid such rare tape.
Sarhelm explained, voice sympathetic. Raindrop dejected look. A frustrated snort, he went on.
However, given that there does seem to be an emergency situation occurring, I assure you I will do what I can to help.
He turned to recruit.
Artificial, escort Miss Raindrop to Canterlot University. Assist her in finding this spell she's looking for there. And sure it happens with all due haste. I'll join you shortly.
Artificial look, hesitant at best, giving Raindrops a wary look that he'd said in no way trusted her story. But the recruit was obedient. Saluting with one wing, Arden said,
Yes, sir! Yes, sir! What will you be doing, sir?
Starhelm sighed.
Too many sirs, he muttered to Larry. As I'll be breaking multiple regulations and bypassing countless points of due process to quickly secure additional assistance for Miss Raindrops and this... Owen, you said?
Raindrops stared at him. Her anger receding just a tad under her surprise.
Yes, Owen. It's a small village near the southern border of South Everfree. I can show you where on a map.
Please tell me there are unicorns in the Night Guard that can teleport!
Not called spell at all, but yes, there are a few.
Starhelm replied quickly.
I think I go smack one of them awake. Oh, the paperwork I'm going to have to fill out after this. Main Raindrops, I do hope this isn't some prank, because otherwise...
No prank. Dead serious. Raindrops said, already turning and stretching her wings with a groan.
Ugh! Never flown so fast in my life!
Okay, where's the university from here? Arn Fizzle took the air.
Come, I'll lead you, but I'm keeping my eyes on you. You seem shifty.
Raindrops heaved out a sign.
Fine! We'll see all you want, but fly while you're doing it!
Despite looking more tired than a guard who pulled a triple shift, the Jasper's Pegasus easily kept pace with the young Night Guard as he flew off towards Canterlot proper. Starhelm watched him go with an appreciative eye. The mare had pushed herself beyond her physical limits, but not even so much so as take a breather. Even if he denied her, he got the impression she would have torn the palace stone down by stone if necessary to get what she wanted. If this was the quality of mares who earned the right to bear the elements, perhaps there was no reason to fear for Equestria's safety after all. Trixie had lost all concept of time. There was no sense of the seconds passing. Each moment could have been minutes, hours, no way of knowing. There was just the spell before her, the pain racking her horn as Trixie pushed every last shred of magic she had through it, and the sight of Bussel laying in her mother's hooves. The sight of the filly may have well been the only thing keeping Trixie's going. The only other thing in her world at the moment was the darkness and its voices. Voices that sounded like her, like her friends, like the ponies of Oaton, even her mentor Luna. The voices taunted her, chided of her, spoke of her failures and weakness. They were relentless. Trixie wanted to gouge her own eardrums out, but part of her thought that this was more of the whisper's influence. At least, the physical whispers were gone, thank Luna for small favors. Still, the multitude of whispering voices would occasionally cease, to be replaced by a single voice that still sounded to Trixie's ears a little too much like her own, if her voice was distorted by a howling wind.
Oh, on your last legs,
the whisper said, shining.
No surprise, your magic was weak to start with. How prideful do you have to be to think you could keep this up as weak as you are?
Trixie didn't have the energy to answer, her eyes stinking with sweat dripping down her face, as she focused on just keeping her magic going. She could feel the last motes of magic in her horn, straining to keep her end of the spell going. This was the worst kind of magical challenge for her, one of raw endurance. Trixie was a unicorn of finesse. She didn't have a lot of magic, but she made creative use of what she did have. But there was nothing to be creative with here. No tricks or loopholes to exploit. No performance to be made. Thus an unending contest to keep her magic going. As much as she was loath to admit it, the Whisperer was right. Her magic wasn't the most prodigious in Equestria history in terms of volume. Even Lyre had greater magic reserve than Trixie did. But size didn't matter. It was how you used it. Except in rituals that required for you to use it on hours on end. That line of thinking was quickly highly embarrassing, and Trixie decided to stop it in its tracks. The voice didn't seem to care about her lack of response, oily gray smoke swirling in front of her eyes. The smoke skirted off at the sparkling white barrier of energy the ritual spell was conjuring, like the angry claws of a caged animal.
Ignoring me makes no difference. You're breaking! And even if you did manage to keep going on, what was the point? Oaton's finished!
A bit into Trixie's mind came the image of a ruined village, Oaton. Tracy's recipe turned to the sharper image of the village flooded, though. Its pony swept away by rapid waters. She shook her head.
That's a lie, is it? How do you know? What makes you think ponies who have no reason to trust each other and every reason to hate each other could walk together even though to save themselves? I don't need to know. I don't need proof,
said Trixie, forcing herself to stay on her hooves, even as her magic started to flicker.
Just a little longer. Just a little more. Don't go out!
She grit her teeth and stared into the form of smoke, realizing that all this was really was smoke in the wind.
I believe that when we purge you from this place and go trotting out of these woods, Oaton will still be there,
ponies don't break as easily as you think!
They don't.
The voice, which was sounding less and less like Trixie's, and more of a something formless, dark guttural.
Ton is broke. Broke like a twig. And that was before I touched her mind. Ponies haven't changed at all. Not in the thousands of years. So much stock put in ideals. But the moment those ideals are tested, you'll eat each other alive!
Tracy tried to respond, but only came out as a groan of pain as she felt her horse magic starting to flare out. She delved into herself, searching for any last scrap of magic she could throw into the spell. Then, quite abruptly, she felt some strains on her horn slacken, giving the guttering flame of magic in her hands to breathe and recover. She looked around in surprise and saw Seath and saw that thus were both pouring out more magic from their horns.
Stop this!
She said, breathing heavily.
You two don't need to pick up my slack!
She sighed, his own face pouring sweat, but he was standing firmly, without shaking.
Don't be an idiot. Just shut up and let us do our part. You can take credit for a layer if you want.
Credit? This has gone beyond who gets credit. You'll burn yourselves out at this rate.
I hardly think you're in a position to lecture us, Miss Trixie, on pushing ourselves toward burnout, said Bushel calmly, despite the way his body shook with the strain of magical effort.
Really? How much of a wool-headed mare destruct my plan so much? Just allow Sheath and I to do what we must.
Gray smoke turned and flowed like a tornado around its confines in the barrier, trying to psych out at all of them, even Picturesque and Bushel. However, the inverted pyramid barrier held the smoke fast, flashing every time the smoke struck, but holding strong. The voice, now formless sowl railed, howled and raised at them,
"Stop pretending to be helping each other! This is not how ponies are supposed to act! You crack under pressure! Become wretched things when the tits are down! Blame and turn on one another! This is the nature of ponies! It's always been!"
"Hey, Saldus, Sleith,"
said Picturesque, ignoring the whisper's voice.
"Remember that time we all took a trip to Canterlot Falls during winter break?"
"Hell," said Sleith, they chuckled. "All right. I remember. That's the day you pushed me into the water."
"I maintain, I slip."
"Sister, I can believe I could testify that you did indeed slip," said Sawdust, who then grinned in a fond manner that was odd to his otherwise controlled features. "Intentionally, into Sheath, just so you could see him wet. As I recall, you confiding in me before you did so."
"Ha! I knew it," said Sheath.
"You just wanted to see how I looked slow. Soaked."
"Oh, fine, you two. I'll mean it. I just wanted to see some wet stallion flank," said Picturesque. "I had my camera ready and everything, but you pulled me into a wire before I could get shot. I had the framing perfect and everything."
"What is this drivel?"
Defoy was distorted into smaller voices.
"You hate each other. You don't trust each other!"
"I remember the night after that more than anything," says Sawdust. "You two had to stay near the fire to stay warm, and I got roped into cooking. Never actually cooked a full meal before. I remember making a giant list of ingredients I need. Half of it stuff I didn't actually turn out to need at all, for cooking such a simple bag of coleslaw and hay fries. You, Sheath, you ended up having to help me anyway, because I somehow managed to catch the hay fries on fire." Sheath sighed, smiling. He had a sad look in his eyes. "Yeah. I think me and Pick forbade you for cooking after that, but we ate the fries, char and all." Picturesque hugged Bustle close, struggling to feel his mane.
"Saldus, I wish you had been there the day I had Bustle. I know you thought it was a mistake for me to move to Oaton, but the party the whole village threw for me and Steve and our new Bustle was incredible. That was the happiest day of my life. The only thing I could have made it better is if my brother had been there."
"Picturesque," Sawdust lowered his head. "I wanted you to be happy. It never sunk in that you were happy. Even if life sent you in a different direction than I thought you wanted. I'm sorry I made a mess of things again."
"I messed up too. Family trait, I guess,"
said Piscaress, stepping back tears, but she was smiling despite of them.
What is the plan, yes?
Said the whispers in a soaring voice. The turning mask of black and gray smoke inside the barrier, lashing against the magic holding it.
Remembering the past doesn't taste the present! Oaton will drown in sorrow! That foe will burn from her own uncontrollability! Your pain, rage, and the spell of fiendry! More and more, and until what was once a piece of a hole has enough strength to be a hole in itself! That won't be happening!
Tracy said past labored breaths. Even with Sawdust and Seath taking more of the ritual's energy unto themselves, she was still running on fumes. How long had they been at this? Was Raindrops any close to returning? What if she couldn't hold out?
No!
She would not let herself think about stopping. She blinked away tears from the lances of pain racking her horn as she dressed up any tiny drop of magic that still laid inside of her as she spoke.
You need negative feelings to get stronger. You want us to hate and mistrust each other. You wanted Oaton and the Lumber Guild to fight, and the Coppercoin family to feel the flames. Even these three,
she gestured at Picturesque, Seif, and Sawdust.
You just want to tear into each other. Ha 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 ha! But that's not what's happening, is it? Oaton, the Lumber Ponies, Count Shining and his ponies, I bet right now they're fighting together to save each other. Tarnished! That mare you thought had broken so thoroughly, my friend is with her right now. I know it, and they'll fight against it. They'll fight against all the anger and hate you tried to put into her, just like these three are fighting it. Yes, we ponies are pretty flawed. I know that better than most. We do things we think are right, but just end up hurting each other and act impulsively, or let our emotions and egos get the better of us. But we learn! We own up to our faults and mistakes and become better ponies for them! I see,
the whisper said in a voice like a piece of frozen at midnight.
Yes, for all that fine speech, you are at the end of your endurance!
Tracy felt it almost the second whisper's words finished. When a unicorn hits that point of burnout, where they've used the last vestiges of their magic, it's a sensation unlike any other. As a feeling where all the feeling of one's body begins to pull away. Like a hole has been cut in a barrel, and the liquid inside is just being let out, leaving behind the cold emptiness. This cold flows from one's core, up into the horn, as life itself is being blown out. A fire flickering out its last embers, with only ash left over. Tracy felt that, as her horn's magical aura struggled, wavered, and with a final, tiny last mote, burned out. Tracy was yanked bodily from the ritual circle with remarkable force. She had been about to collapse anyway, so she really wasn't keen on resisting. The sword just flopped like a boneless fist into the hooves of whoever just pulled her away from the ritual. Her vision was somewhat blurry and darkened, and that last mote of magical energy had only been kept from being used up in the ritual. With her concentration broken, she actually felt the ludicrous exhaustion in her body. The ringing in her ears blocked out much else for the moment. She was both relieved and terrified. Why has she just been pulled out of the ritual?
Trixie! Sunblind, you look at me!
Trixie blinked her eyes and looked up. The chamber ceiling was above, flickering with light and shadows, and hovering above her was a blur of form. Trixie felt warm, strong hooves holding her.
Trixie!
Finally, Trixie's visage stopped acting as she were at the bottom of a lake cleared, showing her a familiar, jasmine-colored pony Trixie was resting her head on. Trixie tried to ignore how remarkably comfortable her friend was as he cleared her dry throat to speak.
Oh, hey, Raindrops.
Trixie tried to raise her hoof to rub at her eyes, but found she couldn't even lift it. The jasmine mare was holding Trixie as she laid on her back on the chamber floor. As Trixie tilted her head to look around, she could see her friend wasn't alone. The chamber had many more occupants now. She recognized Cheerilee and Count Shining, both standing nearby at the edge of the ritual circle. Both ponies looked like they had been through, well, a storm. Count Shining in particular looked soaked to the bone and twice as tired. The Count was shouting something.
Thomas! Be careful! This is not safe!
Trixie turned her head to see Tarnished. The mare was standing where Trixie had been, her horn glowing brightly as it struggled to interface with the ritual spell.
Apparently, she had traded places with Trixie just at the right moment, and the ritual barrier still held. The mare looked even more disheveled, as she had been when Trixie had first seen the other mare. But Tarnus was smiling, and not the crazy, unnatural smile she had worn before. No, this was the smile of a mare who was doing exactly what she felt needed to do.
Oh, it's all right, brother. I think I can do this. This could be my way of paying part of my debt to the ponies that have saved me from this thing!
Yeah! What is this thing again? Anyone know?
Asked the stallion in the armor of Night Guard, a Pegasus of metal gaze, though much else was hard to tell past the uniform and armor. Several other Night Guard were in the chamber. One of them, a younger Pegasus, who was jumping at every shadow in the chamber.
I don't know, Sir Starhelm, but this place makes my mane curl!
Raindrops looked up for Trixie.
Never mind that! Trixie needs help!
I think she's over-channeled.
The elder Night Guard came over, but Trixie was already trying to push herself up, if not to her hooves, then at least into a sitting position.
I'm fine. Didn't over-channel,
the mistress said, her hoof touching her head, and frowning when she found that her hat wasn't there. She spotted sitting on the ground a little ways away, and she reached a hoof to retrieve it, but Raindrops held her close.
You're not moving until I know for sure you're all right,
Raindrops said sternly.
Don't have time for this, Trixie murmured. The whisper. Have to stop it now. You have the other half of the spell thingy?
Spell thingy? Her brain might actually be a little fried. Perhaps it was a good idea to just sit there for a second and catch her breath.
You're Trixie Lulamoon, then! The elder Pegasus Night Guard, Starhelm, said. Your compatriot has gone through great lengths to bring that spell components you require. I hope you know how to use them.
He gestured, and one of the other Night Guard came up, bearing a saddlebag that he removed and opened up. Inside was a roll scroll of parchment and a thick book. The Night Guard removed these and presented them to Trixie. But upon realizing Trixie didn't have enough magic to levitate the objects in question, the Night Guard just set them down in front of her. Trixie stared at these items blankly for a second, before trying to reach over to them, still barely able to move her hooves. Raindrops was quick to help, and Cheerilee came over as well, kneeling in front of Trixie as Raindrops unrolled the scroll.
You look terrible, said Cheerilee. I'm going to suggest a full treatment at Aloe and Lois's spa when we get home, plus a week of sleep.
Oh, I am far ahead of you on plans along those lines,
said Trixie, as Raindrops sorted a scroll.
I don't know anything about magic, said Raindrops, but this was what someone was in the spot Sawdust Sternal's note said, and it looks magical.
Trixie looked at the scroll's contents over, and was almost impressed with the simplicity of what she was seeing. As a mare who wasn't all that into learning magic from written sources, she could at least appreciate the straightforward natural of the ritual component presented on the scroll. It was designed, far as she could tell, to be cast by a single one of the unicorns already performing the barrier portion of the ritual. In doing so, would plug in the new spell into the barrier almost seamlessly.
This looks like what we need,
Trixie said, though there was a note of unease in her voice.
What's the book?
The research journal of the unicorn who translated the spell into scroll, said Raindrops. I just skimmed it enough to confirm this scroll was the right one.
Don't mean to sound pussy, said Sawdust from across the room, his breathing haggard from the effort of continuing casting to hold the barrier.
But perhaps you'd be so kind as to bring the scroll over so we can use it before the rest of us run out of magic?
Trixie tried to rise, but Cheerilee put a hoof on her.
Take a breather, Trixie. Let us take things from here.
Trixie frowned but nodded, taking a deep breath, still feeling the utter cold drain on her body from her ordeal, keeping the first half of the ritual going for so long. She laid back down, looking across the chamber at the ritual. The pyramid-shaped barrier was still holding the swirling mask of dark energy and smoke. And Sheath, Sawdust, and now Tarnus poured their magic into maintaining that barrier, even as the smoke swirled like a hurricane trying to break free. Beneath it all, Pitcheret still held her daughter, bristled close to her side, looking worriedly at her brother and husband as both stallions strained themselves. Neither far behind Trixie of running out of mana. Shiny stood aside with the Count Knight guards, the former giving his sister a look of both concern, fear, and oddly enough, pride. Cheerilee scooped up the scroll and quickly tried it over to Sawdust, who took it and laid it out on the stone floor in front of him. Trixie was still thinking about the arcane writing as he did so.
It was a single arcane pattern that drew in the positive energy from the pony's casting the barrier portion of the spell, and amplified it into a burst of purifying magic, directing on whatever exists inside the barrier. Very straightforward, very simple. Only, Trixie was fairly certain that the spell would put the unicorn who cast it through an incredible amount of strain. A fresh unicorn, who had their magic at full capacity, could handle it. Even a unicorn who had been holding the barrier spell for a little bit could logically take on the purification spell and still be good. But what about the one who had been using up their magic to hold on the barrier for hours? It would cause overchanneling, almost certainly. Sawdust was already channeling his magic to enact the second part of their scroll, a triangle of magical light tracing into the air in front of him and filling with arcane sizzles. He didn't look concerned, just concentrating. Did he not know what the spell would do to him?
Sawdust! Wait!
She shouted, and as she did so, she saw him look at her. Saw his calm, half-lidded eyes that showed not a hint of surprise. He knew. He knew exactly how dangerous this spell was. He'd known it since successing this plan to begin with, because this had been his plan the entire time. Oh, his original plan had called for him, Tarnish, and Steve casting the spell without having to hold on to the barrier for a long length of time. He had intended to do this while still near full strength, not drained from his fight with Trixie and from hours of holding the barrier. But he was going ahead anyway because... He looked at Bushel, smiled sadly. Because it was still the only chance his niece had of surviving. The others looked at Trixie as she shouted, but only Picturesque had looked over at her brother, at Trixie's shouting warning.
Bushel? Brother?
She asked, as the triangular pattern in front of him filled with the final sizzles of the purification spell, and Sawdust, now obscured by the glowing pulse of light that was filling the entire chamber, said, "Sorry, sister. This isn't what I had planned, but it's the best I could do, given the circumstances." The whisper's voice suddenly roared, distorted like the sound of 100 conflicting winds clashing.
"Sacrificing yourself? Do you not care about the plans for the future? Controlling the largest, most powerful city in the realm? Your ambitions?"
"Of course I do,"
says Sawdust, his horn's magic flickering out with the struggling motes of light, just as Trixie's had a moment before.
"I'm surprised myself I'm doing this.
It's strange, though. The moment I realized my family's lives were the cause of my ambitions, something changed. I knew what needed to be done, what was the right thing to do, no matter the price I paid to see it done."
"That's utterly ridiculous! Where does this sudden self-sacrificing drivel come from? There should be nothing like that inside you! You're no hero, so why?"
The light from the purification spell was nearly too bright to look upon now. As the strength of that light was not just stemming from Sawdust's magic, but it was flowing into the spell from the others in the room. Sheath, whose face was a pain, but said determinedly as he looked to his old friend. Tarnished, looked like if she wasn't sure she shouldn't be in Sawdust's place. Picturesque, staring at her brother with wide eyes, tears running, light pulled from each of them into the spell, drawing all the positive energy into a single focal point. Even as Trixie felt most of energy flowing from her into the spell, she looked at the boiling gray cloud of smoke that was the concentrated negative energy fused into the entity that clearly wasn't able to comprehend why a pony would be willing to put their lives at risk to save others.
"Being a hero has nothing to do with it,"
she told the whisper bluntly.
"Doing what's right, that's a toast any pony can make, no matter how many mistakes they've made."
The whisper scoffed, but there was a odd resonation in its tone. There was a blinding flash of light, and a rush of masculine force that drowned out for a moment. Trixie had her face shielded by one of Raindrops' wings. And within the torrent of light, Trixie could hear the faint, distorted voice, the whisper's final words echoing in Trixie's mind.
"Then, heroism is no different than corruption. A choice."
Cut and Dry was exhausted beyond belief. She felt like her horn was cracked, even though she rubbed it more than a few times to make sure it wasn't. She laid against a pile of logs, just sucked in the air. A male voice groaned as some pony flopped down next to her. Cut and Dry looked over, seeing Boothiel lying against the logs,
rubbing his faithful hoof, and shaking himself like a dog, sending water spraying everywhere. Cundine grimaced and wiped her face full of water.
Dang it, Boothill! I'm trying to suffer a peace here!
She said, looking over her own mud-covered form. This had been one Tartarus of a night! But it was over. The storm had finally cleared an hour ago. The black clouds blowing away revealed Luna's star-filled sky above. The sky was already starting to turn lighter shades of periwinkle blue as dawn approached. Cundry never imagined she ever feel so good at the prospect of the sun rising, as she ached to have some warmth in her drenched bones. Around her, dozens and dozens of other ponies also rested, many of them looking so strained they couldn't do more than lay among their fellows, and looked about in shock that they survived the night. The only ponies around who didn't look exhausted was the squad of night guards that milled around the dam. Those ponies had arrived not long before the storm broke, helping out, though few ponies had time to question them on how they'd been shown up. Cut and Dry assumed they had been brought by raindrops. She visited, hoping the mare was all right. They survived. The dam held. The river, despite nearly sweeping over them, had been held back. Cut and Dry had a hard time believing it. But ultimately, she could only attribute their success on a combination of miraculous factors. Calcine's leadership had been impressive, for one. And Cut and Dry couldn't feel more pride surge through her and remembering her lord diving through a thick of chaos, keeping every pony focused on what needed to be done. Even in that one harrowing moment they nearly lost him, she couldn't thank the own ponies enough for pulling him out of the water. A strange feeling, considering she felt so much scorn for the own pony folk not too long ago. But those own ponies really pulled through. Their help had been key. Cut and Dry had to grudgingly admit she'd been impressed with some of them. The Lumber Guild, too, and those beavers. Cut and Dry still found it odd that an entire clan of critters had been brought by Count Shiny's sister to help.
Well, knight,
Boothill said, stretching popping limbs.
If only I could have found a good mare to make it even wilder with.
Cut and Dry groaned.
Boothill, please, don't. I don't have the energy for you and your one-track mind.
She looked around.
See my brother anywhere? Lucky Key, over yonder.
Boothill gestured toward the east end of the dam.
Still working with one of them Oaton mares, double and triple checking the patches on that end of the dam. Think your bro's going to get some before I do, the way the mare was eyeing him.
Cut and Dry sighed, pushing herself to her hooves. She wiped out her tabard, trying to get enough mud off of that the copper coin red fist could show through.
I better go check on him. They organized a party to head into woods. I'm worried about the count.
That is most wise, but also unnecessary, said a rich, strong female voice from above. Cut and Dry looked around confused for a moment. Then she saw Boothill looking up to the sky with wide, boggling eyes. Cut and Dry followed his gaze and felt her own jaw drop. Hovering in the air upon waps of her wide wings, whose colored mass of darker shades in the night sky, was Equestria's monarch. Princess Luna was free of any royal regalia, and had a windswept coat, as he had been flying non-stop. That minor detail barely registered to Cut and Dry, though, over the simple shock of seeing the actual Princess of the Night landing in front of her, and tucking her wings to her side. Very nice wings. Over the most subtle and well-toned body Cut and Dry had ever...
What are you thinking, Cut? It's the Princess! Get your mind focused and stop noticing how her muscles ripple under her subtle coat while she was. Gah!
What? Was all about Cut and Dry commands in terms of conversation. Princess Luna raised a coy eyebrow, but her features quickly became a frown of concern as she swept her gaze over the scene before her.
I see I have arrived too late to do much aid in matters. You ponies have my sincerest apologies. I made all the haste I could afford to arrive here as fast as possible. She said, her voice sympathetic. In any case, I see ponies emerging from the edge of the forest, my apprentice and her friends among them. Let us go meet them. It seems among them some may have been injured.
The night guards, who had been waiting by the dam, immediately came over to stand at attention for their princess, while the Oaton, Lumber Guild, and Copper Pine ponies all gawked. Princess Lonnie and Luna didn't seem to pay the gawking much mind, instead giving those ponies around her a warm, even a apologetic smile.
Cut and Dry had only managed to register what the princess said, and could only wonder how the princess knew Count Shining and the others were coming back. As looking toward the forest, she couldn't see anything. Boothiel, meanwhile, was staring at the princess with absolutely no sense of shame. If Princess Luna noticed, she wasn't reacting to the guard drinking in the sight of her like a barrel of cider. Cut and Dry interceded on the princess's behalf. I smacked her fellow guard upside the head. "Seize the princess!" "You were staring too," he said. "Blast it." He had a point. Within minutes, Princess Luna, with an escort of night guard, and with Cut and Dry, and a detail of the copper coin house guard in tow, was going out into the field surrounding the forest. Cut and Dry was surprised, only slightly, as she saw the ragged band of ponies emerging from the tree line. Cut and Dry made a mental note, never to underestimate the senses of an alicorn. The group of ponies that approached the princess and her entourage was a sight. Many of them was looking worse for wear as the ponies around the dam. Cut and Dry recognized Count Shining walking alongside his sister, and the magenta mare, Cheerilee, all three looking equal parts relieved, but also trepidation upon seeing Princess Luna. Raindrops tried tall and strong, was a warm sight to Cut and Dry's heart. The Pegasus did look magnificent. The princess's beauty was ethereal, unreal. Cut and Dry found she preferred the more solid, identifiable charm of the athletic Raindrops. Upon Raindrops' back was the azure blue form of Trixie Lulamoon, head and all conscious, but looking utterly tired. Cut and Dry felt a stab of jealousy, twisting to trade places with Trixie, wondering what that strong, lean Pegasus back felt like to drape on. Focus, Cut! Beside Raindrops, two other ponies walk, Picturesque and Sheath. They had two ponies on their back. Picturesque was carrying the little filly Bushel, who was awake and holding her mother around her neck. Her forehead still bore a glowing horn of energy, but even at this distance, Cut and Dry could tell the horn's glow was a lot more subdued than before. Upon Sheath's back was the Lumber Guild leader, Sawdust. He wasn't moving. Behind the ponies, a small squad of night guards trotted, as if keeping guard from anything that might come from the forest. The two parties met, and Princess Luna looked upon the tired ponies before her.
Trixie! Cheerilee! Raindrops!
The princess said, a concern full in her voice.
I've been told an evil threatened this village, one of dire nature. I came as fast as I could.
Trixie raised a weary hoof.
Dealt with!
The Selmare let out a heavy sigh, her eyes glancing over to Sawdust and ceased back.
Not without cost. Don't suppose you brought some aether potions with you?
Princess Luna looked at the stallion, who Cut and Dry could see was still breathing, but was unconscious. The question about either potions could only mean one thing. Burnout.
I did not, said the princess. But since items are two teleport spells away, along with medical aid and anything else that is needed, Sodham, I see you back there. Does any threat to this area still remain?
Nightguard stepped up, offering a quick brow.
No, my princess! The danger is past. Thanks to the efforts of the ponies you see before you, there is some interesting wildlife in the forest, but one of the mares here claims they're now a threat.
Princess Luna looked over the ponies arrayed before her and nodded.
Very well. Let us tend to our wounded and fallen. I can hear the tale once the needs of my ponies are looked after. I can see this is going to be a very long tale indeed.
Yeah, Luna. It was a long tale. 2 hours, 33 minutes of this. I think I'm with Trixie on this. I think I go sleep now. See you guys tomorrow.
99.